It is 2:30. We're going to call to order. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. Dubay?
Present.
Mrs. Hilton?
Coming in. She's on her way.
Okay. Mr. Hubler?
Present.
Mr. Lipsky?
Present.
Mrs. Ross? Mrs. Servio?
Here.
And Dr. Spencer now.
Dr. Spencer will be late today, but should be in attendance.
Right. So 5 and 2 right now.
Thank you. Do we have any hearing of school district patrons?
No.
Wonderful. Presentations?
Well, I'd like to thank, well, first of all, we want to congratulate, we're going to have a joint congratulations for Kyle Kostenko, a former graduate of High School North, and actually a former student of mine at Middle School East when I was a principal there, so that was a long time ago. But Kyle has won a very prestigious award that is, I don't know the statistic of how many people earn now, but winning a Fulbright is a very rare thing, and Mr. Forlini is here, and our dual role school board president, as well as representative of Congressman Mitchell, both Mr. Forlini and Hillary representing Congressman Mitchell here, have a resolution from the congressman, and then we also have a Bullitt District Award to speak about Kyle. So congratulations, and Mr. Forlini.
Well, thank you. Yeah, on behalf of Congressman Mitchell, I'd like to just really congratulate Kyle. What a tremendous accomplishment. And I have a little bit on the, for those that don't know, and I didn't know what the Fulbright Scholarship was, so bear with me for just a minute. I'm just going to talk a little bit about it. But J. William Fulbright, he was a congressman, he was a prominent gifted American statesman of the 20th century. His political career was over 30 years in Congress and was distinguished by his unequal contribution to international affairs, marked by his tenure as the longest-serving chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. He had a profound influence on American foreign policy, and his vision for mutual understanding shaped the extraordinary exchange program bearing his name. With the support of the United States government through binational partnerships with foreign governments, the Fulbright Scholarship Program sponsors U.S. and foreign participants for exchanges in all areas of endeavor, including the sciences, business, academia, public service, government, and the arts, and continues to increase mutual understanding between the people of the United States and the people of other countries. And if you know anything about the work I've done even with Italy, this is really important to me, so I'm really excited for it. His legislation established the Fulbright program, passed by the Senate by unanimous consent in 1946, and drew strength from the U.S. national commitment to develop post-war leadership engaged constructively with the community of nations. The first participants in the Fulbright program went overseas in 1948, funded by war reparations and foreign loan repayments to the United States. This program has had extraordinary impact around the world. There have been more than 250,000 Fulbright students, scholars, and teachers. Many of them have made significant contributions within their countries, including the U.S., as well as overall goal of advancing mutual understanding. And I'm sure we got a kid here that's going to be exactly that. So that brings me to Kyle. He was, as we heard, a 2013 graduate of Lance Creuse High School North, graduated valedictorian, spoke a little bit with him beforehand, and you talk to this kid, he's squared away, man. He's got things going. You can just tell he's going to be very, very successful in his life, as he already is. Kyle plays the clarinet. So he's going to be honored, he's honored for this 2019-2020 Fulbright Scholarship. He'll be traveling to Romania, which sounds just incredible. He'll be studying Romanian music, specifically experimental and contemporary styles. Yeah, I don't know what that means. Kyle's got a bachelor's degree as well as a master's degree in music performance, and he's been studying the clarinet for quite some time. Board members, can please join me in congratulating Kyle. Congressman Mitchell wants to congratulate you with a congressional certificate. If you could come up here, let me give that to you now.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Oh, we got another one here too, maybe just. Come on over here, I think somebody's taking pictures, so.
We took one here. Up at the wall.
For achievement for receiving Fulbright scholarship for 1920, and all we ask is when you get to come home, that you tell your dad how it's going so we can talk to him about it.
Did you get a good picture?
I have a couple pictures, yes.
Yeah.
All right, who's first?
I'll go first. Surprise, surprise.
Oh, no, open mine up like this, or wanna do?
There you go, yep, yep.
Both, yeah.
There you go, one, two, three. That's all right, if you wanna go, Nikki.
You wanna go?
Good, I'm good, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, wonderful.
Over here, what?
Gotta get my.
Yeah, you can.
Thank you. I got it.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
We already did a bunch of them in the boardroom.
Oh, that's.
Wonderful. We always like having presentations, thank you, Mr. Forlini, and the Congressman's office, of course.
Thank you very much.
Yes, congratulations.
Enjoy the rest of your meeting.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
It's a public meeting, Mr. Forlini.
He knows.
Thank you so much, yes. And yes, we always like to showcase and support our students, whether they're current or former, when they receive wonderful recognition like that. Any other questions?
Yeah, thank you.
So superintendent.
Thank you. I'd like to follow up with, are you just gonna switch them, Nikki, or should I sit up there, what would be better?
I can, if you want.
That'd be great.
I'm gonna get real close to Steve.
Okay.
Do you notice, he just backed up though.
Can I have that mouse?
That mouse.
Thank you.
This is a version of a presentation that I've given at buildings, oh, sorry.
Hold on, there might possibly be a closed session that we might wanna add.
Oh, excuse me, yes, we may be at, we're likely to add a closed session. If the time is late, I'll do it via email communication this evening, because it's not something, I just wanna tell you something. But if it's not, I'd like to have a closed session to discuss an employee matter, be under the heading of employee matter.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So, this is a presentation I've given to several buildings, and continue to spread the message and to give further explanation for. This is more of a historical understanding of, yes, that'd be fine, of where we're at and why we're there when it comes to funding our schools. And I think this information is, it'll be a little small on the screen, but I'll be happy to email it out afterwards, and I might stand at the front so I can point things out, actually. This has been taken from a variety of sources, but I just wanna give the little story here, because now obviously we're right in the heat of the budget process, 5 months later than we wish it was, but it's still going on, and we don't have all the answers, but go ahead, Nikki. It's important, remember, and I'll highlight these if they're hard to read. Remember, the adequacy study in 2018 was completed with support, financial support from associations that all of us in this room have been involved with at one time or another. So it was a large group of people that put in money for this, including Better Business Bureau, as well as Chamber of Commerce and a variety of other non-education-based groups. This company that did this is a large company, and what they focus on is adequacy studies for schools. The answer, the question they're trying to answer is not what would be great to have or what would be wonderful for schools. It is actually a baseline cost estimate of what schools need in order to meet demands that are either placed on them legislatively or just or academic needs of kids to all be successful and move through school. So they've done this in lots of other places before. This is not a Michigan piece individually, and it's also not something that was done with a small group of people. So you've heard about this before because this was concluded a year and a half ago. And remember, some significant findings of this, full admission, all of them quite expensive. But again, this charge was, what will make our schools more successful? What do schools need to be as successful as we are mandating them to be, either via MBE, U.S. Department of Ed, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so one was smaller class sizes, student-teacher ratios of 20-1 in kindergarten through grade 3 and 25-1 in grades 4 through 12. Instructional coaches and much more time for teacher planning built into the day. student support for counselors, social workers, and psychologists. They get a little bit into ratios for that because, as you know, some schools don't have any of these positions anymore. We're fortunate to still maintain these positions, although not at ratios that we would like. We've had some conversations about counselor ratios in the past, and they are all lower than obviously we would like, and the study recommends a better ratio than we have. But again, some schools in a much worse position in this area. Sufficient nurses or health aides to provide medical care to students. Again, this a lot of these positions are to allow teachers to continue to focus on instruction of kids and not with the numerous distractions with student needs that are non-academic in nature. So there's a lot of issues, and good health aides and nurses also provide emotional support to children as well. It's not just physically fixing the issue, calling the parents, whatever. It's calming the student down, finding out why they're hurt, et cetera, et cetera. So some of this is a more intangible effect than just applying a Band-Aid to a student. And the class can continue, learning can continue. It's not stop. We have to fix this problem over and over again. Okay, before and after school programs, summer learning opportunities, particularly for ELL students and especially ELL students in poverty. ELL students in poverty were identified as the greatest need at-risk group in this study. More money, $190 per student for instruction and library materials, and $250 for school computer and technology equipment. And this is not bond money we're talking about. This is capital money that would come through the general fund. So this is not voted money. This would be enhancement on the foundation grant for these specific needs. Okay. The last couple of recommendations of this, and if you haven't, we talked about it a lot last year. It's very long. It's very extensive. The bottom line is the recommended base cost for K-12 education students for foundation grant is $9,590, obviously well above what we're currently receiving. Important though, critically, and we are a strange state when it comes to this. I don't know a better word to use than strange, but we're unusual in the sense that many other states provide base foundation grants for core services, and then they give money for other services that are non-core on top of that. We're all in. So when we receive one amount of money, that is assumed to include transportation, extra costs for students with greater needs, all sorts of other ancillary services, whatever we choose to spend the money on through the budgetary process. In other states, and this is recommended through this study, is that $9,590 is a base cost for a regular general education student. Does not include any transportation costs, food service costs, capital costs, etc. And they assume pension at 4.6% of wages. That's currently nowhere near where it is. We're being deferred down to what, 26%?
26.18.
Paying 26.18, but the actual cost is closer to 35, 36.
36.
Okay, so an additional, then the rest of the study talks about weighting based on needs of kids. So again, it's not, they talk about getting away from the cookie cutter approach, getting away from the one size fits all model, that you add enhancements to the base foundation grant based on actual needs in local districts, not just based on where you were in 1994 when Proposal A passed, basically. So for example, 35% additional weight for students in poverty. And then interestingly, for ELL students, it's based on their score is what they recommend. The lowest ability learners with reading and writing would get more enhancement, up to 70%. Students that are nearly proficient, 35%. So there's logic behind this because greater need means greater services. I think it's important too that none of this is, a lot of this is not just about doing more or doing more with the same people you have. This is asking for a dramatic increase in the number of adults we would have in our school system, and the money that's being requested by this study comes from, or would go to, more adults with kids, basically. Adults that would interact with kids more regularly. Kids with greater needs would have more adults supporting them and working with them in smaller environments. Okay, and then the last one is special education, and for those of you, I mean, federally, that we've been underfunded by the mandate of special ed, supposed to get, I believe, 19%. We're getting 19, what's the total, 40%, right? I mean, we're getting around 19%.
Close to 17.
Oh, 17 now, okay. So we're less than half of what the federal statute says we're supposed to receive in special education reimbursement. And again, it's a scale based on how functional the students are based on their disability. Okay, go ahead. All right, now, moving forward to
Now, this is no more adequacy studies. It's the focus, the next part here is there are some facts about where we would be if other things had happened since Proposal A. And a lot of this is caused by Proposal A, unintended effects of Proposal A in 1994. So just the general fund alone, which is school aid fund, is not the general fund. This is roads, bridges, etc. If the general fund had just kept up with inflation, there'd be $5 billion more in it. That's not our fault. We didn't have anything to do with that as a school community, but that's just a reality. When you see the borrowing from the school aid fund to pay off the general fund, this is one of the reasons why that's been occurring since that period of time. Go ahead. So this is a, you know, you can pull out any statistic you want, and some look better than others, and this is kind of a narrow statistic, admittedly. However, it's damaging. You know, this is a damaging statistic. It's a Michigan-based statistic. I can interpret what this little scratch says here for you in a second. But this is the NAEP test. The NAEP is not something that we're scored on. We don't give it to all kids. The U.S. government randomly decides a sample each year. We've had teachers give it, voluntold. You know, the principal receives a letter and says, congratulations, your fourth grade students will be taking the NAEP test this year. That's how that works. These are this is how they compile national statistics on education. It's not for accountability. The bottom line is this is change. This is percent change improvement over the period of 2003 to 2017. Michigan last on the list. I mean, I believe that's factual. Now, you can probably show another slide that's not about change, it's just about proficiency or about many other things, but the bottom line is Massachusetts is number one, very high funded state, over $18,000 per student in the foundation grant, and they just have more staff working with kids. It sort of mirrors what the study suggests, which is more adults with kids, more highly trained adults with kids.
But that also does include all of their grounds, all of their everything.
That
includes
may include
all of their buildings.
That's still twice as much, right, exactly.
There's a lot
that's
of things included
pieces.
In that.
But I'll show you, there's no real pattern here. I mean, this idea that some states are thought of as wealthier versus not other states, it doesn't. There's no other pattern through here. The dark lines represent other Midwestern states. So every state has a different priority when it comes to education funding, and this is not a new issue. This has been going on a long time. I mean, people talk about, it's just snobbiness, I think, to think that certain states should do better than others because they're seen as wealthier or whatever. Mm-hmm. But for example, Massachusetts up here, I think, thought of as a pretty, it is a highly educated state, lots of people with bachelor's degrees. But we have other states where that's not the case, too. There's a lot of southern states here who have generally been regarded as poor and not well-performing who have made a big push, a big effort to do something about it. And
Arkansas?
You see states like Alabama, Mississippi, and other states who are now spending a lot more money on education. Okay, go ahead. This one is my least favorite. So what you see here is, this is since 1995 of all 50 states. 95 on purpose because that's the year after Proposal A passed. So everyone starts at the same spot. Blue lines represent, I couldn't tell you what every state is in this situation. But you see natural downward trends. If you look carefully, you see a lot of dips in the 2007, 2008, 2009 area when we had national federal recession. And what you see generally, no one, except for one, I don't know who this is, no one is less than they were in 1995, except for one, the red line, us. So interestingly, we were in the norm, 2001, 2002, we were basically average when it comes to, at least average when it comes to inflation-adjusted K-12 education revenue, but then we fell off. I don't obviously know statistically exactly, but I'm looking at Greg, who's sitting in the hallway right now for no other reason besides that he's sitting out there. But Greg,
we have chairs.
If we talked about this before, and we're sure that if you were studying this as a statistician, you would throw this line out because it's so much an outlier from the norm of the rest of the data. Okay, go ahead. So this comes from this slide comes from the governor's office as part of her original budget. Not so concerned, directly we're not so concerned about these two pieces. I have no idea where these two are, how alive or not alive these middle and right pieces are in the current negotiations between the House and the Senate.
But the one on the left is the one that would show some of these enhancements that we talked about in some of our budget conversations, and have many and have been concurred, at least in the Senate side and somewhat in the House side. However, go ahead with the next one. The idea, and I think everyone agrees with this, it's just how to get there. We've had a shell game going on when it comes to school aid, because everyone knows that school aid, there's a lot of statutory requirements that feed school aid. School aid's gigantic, it is a large fund for the state, and there's a lot of things that have to go in. For example, how sales tax goes in is controlled, how 18 mills on non-homestead, that's controlled how it goes in. The gas, the lottery money, one of my favorite examples. If the auditing is correct, the money does go in, true, but there's no, very few statutory requirements about how the money's pulled back out then. So we have this system where they have to put the money in a certain way, but not how it's shared out if they feel that there's needs in other places. For us, that's primarily been for roads and for higher ed. So when higher ed was short or roads were short, we've been the balancing book for that. School aid has actually been a well-performing fund since probably 2010, 2011. It's actually done well. So in other words, the system was working for that. Just these other two were not doing well out of general fund and transportation fund. So money's been taken from ours to them. Okay. So if you look, and this is, Mary was inferring this about Massachusetts, because it is a valid argument to say, okay, $8,500 isn't really all the money you get per kid, right? It's not, because we receive title funds for certain schools and certain populations of kids. We receive ELL support funds. We receive 31A funds from the state of Michigan. There's other types of funds. So this is adjusted for total revenue from 94 to 2015. And even if you make the argument you make more, you get more money than everyone thinks you do, it's still significantly down from where it was. Okay. This is one that doesn't affect us so much, but as you know, one of the reasons that Proposal A's had a problem is because immediately after passing Proposal A, all the hold harmless districts were supposed to get reset to a normal foundation amount, whatever normal is. But they went nuts about it. Because if you were hold harmless in 94, you were receiving quite a bit more than the average per kid. And they successfully lobbied, and within 1 year of that time, they were back receiving their hold harmless money. So there are districts in our county, and they are based on how much commercial money you had in 1994, not what's going on today, that receive a lot more than the base amount. And that's been great for them, but it's also taken away from, we have to complain about that because we weren't hold harmless and we don't receive that money, and that's not been redistributed. It was supposed to be, didn't happen. Even if that's true, you see that there's a decline for all types of districts in that period, in this period of time, as far as the foundation allowances in real terms. So every district, max districts in 95, they earned as much as they possibly could, down. Median districts, down. Hold harmless districts, down. Minimum districts, down. Okay. This one is a difficult one for us. You can see there was an improvement in at-risk funding for the first several years of 31A. This is the 31A grant we're talking about, the state of Michigan money received for at-risk identified pupils. And it was up to over $1,100. And you can see, and some of this, I mean, there's little argument to make during this period of time that decline was likely, because we had very difficult decisions. The state couldn't balance. There's a lot of things that couldn't be balanced in the state budget. There was real economic problems. But since then, like I said, the school aid fund has improved significantly, but this has not gone back in the direction. I mean, no one expects it to go to here in 1 year, but moving back in that direction. Go ahead. Here's the story why. Because look, this is the performance of school aid for the first several years of Proposal A. Okay, and what you see is general fund was doing so well, they actually were giving money to the school aid fund to to meet what Proposal A said was supposed to happen, okay, to follow Proposal A. We were receiving the money in school aid fund. And then, in that 2008, 2009, they said, I'm sorry, we can't do that anymore. And in fact, we have to take money out of school aid fund one time, it was actually written as one time, in order to balance the books of the general fund. We're really sorry, we promise not to do this again. And then the next year they kept that, and then since then, transfer out, transfer out, transfer out. It's been $1.5 billion. We've had many conversations with our elected officials about this issue, and it's really difficult to pinpoint how, because it's a little here, it's a little here, it's a little here. There's not one law that passed that just made this happen. But over time, you can see the overperformance of school aid has been to the other funds have appreciated that. Not to say that we weren't at the beginning, but this is what the law said was required to fully fund us according to Proposal A. Go ahead. Almost done. Another piece of this, which is something Nancy and I have talked about before, that this term encroachment means how much money you have to spend regular ed money for special education services per mandates of IEPs and other types of regulations. And Macomb County here is in the category of $700 to $1,200. Ours is like about $850 the last time I heard about this statistic. That means on average $850 from our foundation grant is going to support requirements, not options, requirements for special education services that are supposed to be federal dollars. Okay. So this is old now, because then I'll wrap up with where I think we're at right now. If you go to, the Senate may have the version of this too, but the bottom line is, I think I talked about this when we were going through budget at the very beginning, that according to, if you highlight over districts, you see what the proposal from the governor's office was for this year. And it is starting to break with Proposal A. It is following along in the model of, based on your need, you receive money on what the reality of your district is. For example, special education, at risk, not just here's all the money, whatever you want to do with it. It's actually categorized to be spent on needs based on your actual needs. That makes sense, which is what the report back at the beginning of this conversation recommended, was a model that's based on needs, not just a one sum of money. Okay. And then I'll just say, here's what's happening now. There's been a lot of rumors going on. The worst rumor I heard, but is likely not to happen now, is, you know, that some people talk shutdown in July, because October 31st is the deadline for them. That's not an extension, that's a real deadline. When we were receiving budgets in June, that was before they had to give them to us, but they had made that commitment because the fact that we're not on a fiscal calendar, you know, they are. But the bottom line is now, basically the governor and the Speaker of the House and the majority leader have been meeting all summer and no one else has. So they've had a lot of meetings, the three of them together, and there are several proposals on the table to get the money the governor wants for roads, which would make this a reality. One of which I heard is, I believe, not a very good idea, and that's why I want to bring it to your attention. And we have to be careful with this, because to say no, the alternative is, you know, I'm not sure where the money's coming from, but one of the solutions is to finance the state school pension system.
The future.
Correct. So as you recall, new teachers in our district and across the state don't receive traditional pension system anymore. For several years, they weren't receiving the traditional pension, they were receiving a hybrid. So we actually have four systems, but for practical terms, three. Traditional pension, hybrid, where it's partial 401k, partial guaranteed return, and then now basically 401k, okay? And with a small employee match as required. That was to pay down incurred debt in the pension fund. And Governor Snyder, I think, would argue was actually correct when he said something has to be done about this. And if we had followed that plan, we actually would be spending down and everything would be solvent within about 10 years. Okay? Unfortunately, it makes us nervous because the argument's now being said, why don't we put bonds on this? Why don't we bond this? Why don't we just defer the debt out another 20 years, 30 years in order to fix this problem right this second? And that's problematic, obviously, because then suddenly the fund doesn't have any money anymore, and then suddenly we're back to where we were 10 years ago with the pension fund,
mm-hmm.
which was underfunded. So worried about the prophecy fulfilling itself on this issue, but at the same time, it's difficult because revenue's the problem here. It's got to come from somewhere. So everyone acknowledges that there's not enough revenue to meet the demands of the road funding. It's just a big debate as to how that will happen. This would be a way to do it, with obviously not raising taxes on most people, although some of us in this room would not appreciate that being the result. But I think for the general public, that's probably easy for them to swallow because they don't receive an education pension and won't. But for those of us who do, we've spent a lot of money ourselves. I'll just stand on the box myself. We were given options as to how to stay in the pension system more than once, and we paid more money out of our checks personally in order to be told this was what will fix it, and it would be very difficult if that was done for nothing. So that's that. That's the last thing I've heard. The other thing is some talk of regional tax only. That's very interesting, like a tri-county tax. Because we were the ones that complain about all the roads, so all the outstate people are like, well, fine, then why don't you pay more taxes for your roads? And a few other things. I do think they'll get something done. I'm not sure that very many people will be happy, but we'll see what happens. Not much update, but I know the three of them have been meeting, and I don't think either caucus is too happy about that because the Republicans and the Dems don't know what speaker and the majority leader aren't telling the Republican caucus what's going on, and the governor's not really telling the Democratic caucuses what's going on. And I think that's their agreement, is to work together, the three of them, without letting details out at this point. Sharon?
What happened to the law that said you could not be underfunded on your pension plan?
Right, that's exactly why we were paying for stabilization.
What I'm saying is, when that occurred, there should have been major consequences to a goodly number of people, and there weren't. And now they give you these options, like you said, we're paying more out of our check.
Like
this is what we're going to do, and now they're thinking, oh, this isn't going to work, so let's just push it down 20 more years. We know that it's just going to buy more time to put us back in the same place we've already been. There is a law that says you cannot do this, and yet we have been in this state for a really long time. I'm, besides angry about the way this is going, I'm very angry that our elected officials from way back then through today are doing nothing substantial to truly fix this. What is our recourse as school board members? What is our recourse as taxpaying citizens? Because they're not listening, they're not seeing what you put together, they're not paying attention, they actually don't care, because if they did, this would have been fixed.
Well, I think one of the issues, though, is that the solution, the all-in-one solution, is super expensive. I mean, the bottom line is, to do all of this the way it should be done, is the problem is when you create small neglect over a long period of time, you have this gigantic problem that's very difficult to solve.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think there, it's, I'm still feeling like, for the first time in a while, people aren't saying, no, that road looks fine. No. There's way too few kids in that classroom. You know what I mean? No one's really saying that. Actually, the report last year was not really met with a ton of factual resistance.
Okay.
It's what to do about it and how difficult that's going to be is where the rubber meets the road on this issue. And I say, and since they are not in session all summer, it's hard for me to answer that question until we start hearing people what they really say when they come back into session on this. But I think there's going to be, compromise will be painful for several members of the legislature on this. And I think it's going to be very interesting because I think the Dems aren't happy with the governor. I think the Republicans aren't happy with the majority leader and the Senate leader. So you're going to see a strange
mm-hmm.
vote on this.
Don?
Tony Ferlini is one of the brightest people in the room when it comes to this. He'd worked very hard to address the pension system years ago. And when some schemes were brought out, he identified the issues with that. And it was part of the solution that got us to the hybrid system. If we ever want advice or discussion, again, he is one of the most knowledgeable people in the state on what works and what doesn't work. And his opinion and his influence on this might be very beneficial.
For you, maybe.
So I've had a little bit of conversations with individuals in regards to this, just because I kind of fall into certain scenarios and being a school board member, the budget always, I always, any local elected official I see, I always bring up the budget. Could you finish that up for us? That would be great. So while they are not in session in the summer, there are many that have been traveling back to Lansing to try and work out, work on the budget and work out these issues. And yes, the three of them are meeting, but they're not meeting without input, I guess. Okay. I would say. And it's my understanding, the last conversation that I had was actually last week, and it's my understanding that the House and the Senate are pretty well set on a budget, and it's just getting the governor to come on board. Or getting, so it, while they've had different scenarios and different options presented, they've come to a final agreement, and now they just got to get her on board.
I read that there's going to be an announcement within 2 weeks.
Yes.
Last week.
They're very close.
And it would be all three of them making the announcement, and they weren't going to make it. So
correct.
That seems...
progress anyway.
I'm assuming that's positive, but I have no idea what
and
that means.
The one thing that I've heard out of all three is it will be, and I don't know how to take this, or it will be record-breaking funding for education.
In a good way or a bad way?
Yeah.
That's
true.
All
yes.
they say is record-breaking
yes.
funding
yeah, yeah, yeah.
for education.
That's a good question, Lisa. Seriously.
Oh,
no,
to
yeah,
which
you never
my
know.
Response
no.
is always, I'll believe it when I see it.
Yeah.
And how. But
yeah, the how.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The how, yes.
So that's, yeah.
So that's, I just wanted to give you that. Information. I've got more things on that historically and non-homestead versus homestead, other things like that we could talk about in the future, but not to take any more time up right now
correct.
Because the update is, at the end of this, is that there's a very short update.
Yeah.
And so you're going to send us
thanks.
Those?
Yeah, I'll send you the slides.
Thank you.
Yes.
That's good, great information.
All right. So, superintendents, item two, human resources job description.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
As was told to you last week, and per current policy, all jobs below supervisor level are brought to the board for review before posting. This is a job duties list, a job description of, I'm still having trouble with the packet loading, but I know what it is, of the assistant superintendent for HR. I'm looking for comment, consideration, so we can move on this position. Obviously, we don't want to rush, but we know what the timeline is. I'm not saying this would be requested, but there is no option of an extension of Mike's employment to do this position because of ORS rules when it comes to retirement. You have to declare when that day is going to be. You can't have any physical appearance in a school for a lengthy period of time after that. So, I'm just preempting that question because that's not possible. September 30th.
So there's a couple of issues with this. Where did this come from?
Sure. This job description?
Yeah.
It's an existing job description we had, and I looked at it and reviewed it as well.
That
I mean,
we had?
Yes.
Oh, I think we probably got it from somewhere. There's a couple of things. The MISD. Where is it?
Teacher of the Year program?
Yeah, that's a conflict of interest because you can't have your HR person doing the Teacher of the Year.
Do you know where it is?
Coordinates MISD
it's the
Teacher of the Year.
It's in the bullets.
Oh, I see, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll tell you how that works, and I don't know if that will make a difference or
I
not.
I don't mind him helping with it. It can't be in here because this ends up being a legal document. This is a job description. This is job responsibilities. This is what they're legally
right.
held to.
It is rather minor
so
as well,
it
Mary.
It needs to come out.
It is rather minor.
Yeah.
Any other thoughts on that? Here's what happens. They contact for the coordination to occur. We actually run this in the buildings, and the buildings present names, and that's just the liaison to the ISD to do the awards.
It allows favoritism.
So it's just trying to follow this, then how should we handle this within the district when the MISD says...
It's not that they can't do it. It's that it can't be part of the contract. It can't be part of what's going to be a legal document for their job description.
If it's not in their job description, then why would they do it?
Well, there are a lot of things I'm sure that fall under HR that aren't on this description.
Sure, but I don't know why. I'm trying to understand what is so. If it goes to our buildings, and they make recommendations, are you fearful that the HR director would then decide yay or nay based on their personal preferences?
Okay, they're also in charge of making sure that discipline is followed through with. Okay. This creates favoritism, or it doesn't have to, but it creates the perception of. It just needs to come out of the legal document.
No, I heard you. I'm just trying to understand why it is...
I'm not sure that I can explain it adeptly enough.
Couldn't you say that of any principal in a building? Couldn't you say that of anyone in a position to be
you
making this choices?
But
this is
say that
not
any
listed
supervisory
in the
position.
You know what I mean? It's just the fact that it's listed in the job description that comes up with the legal. It's I'm going to put it in how I would understand it. Things that you can and can't put in an IEP. There are certain things that you do put in an IEP, and there's certain things you don't
mm-hmm.
put in an IEP because
mm-hmm.
it's a legal binding document.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a responsibility that we would not put in this because of it being a legal binding document, but
so,
it would still be a responsibility.
So anything else in this document that would be legal and binding we need to take out because it would be a legal and binding document?
Correct.
No, I'm asking the question, is there anything else in this? Because it'll be legal and binding.
Right.
Anything else we need to take out of here?
No, I've got a couple of things.
That's what I'm asking the question for.
Okay. I don't see anything else, do you?
I don't.
Okay.
I didn't even see that.
Don?
One of the last things is that this is not an exhaustive list of duties performed by this position. You have that saving clause in most anyone, so
yeah.
I see no issue with pulling that.
Okay.
I'm sorry,
what
did you say issue.
Then?
I just didn't understand
there's
the
a clause, as in most, this is not an exhaustive list of all the duties performed for this position. So this may these other duties that we're talking about may fall under that at direction of the superintendent, but to delete it, I don't think would be an issue.
It's a legal document, Don.
Correct.
That has to come out.
Oh, he's
agreeing with
you, Mary.
He's absolutely 100%
agreeing with you. He's agreeing with you. So as we discuss and continue the meeting, let's make sure we're going through the chair just so that we can kind of everybody make sure
okay,
that
so
they can listen to each other.
So the next one is, you have maintains the wage salary administration program through audits, job analysis, salary surveys, and recommendations for job descriptions and job evaluation.
Where are you?
The assistant superintendent of human resources cannot be responsible for evaluation and discipline both, so we need to remove job evaluation because they can't be responsible for the evaluating anybody that's not their direct underling.
What about their direct reports?
I think
no.
we have an issue
okay.
there.
Okay, so if you want to put that in there, what you're putting in here is maintains the wage and salary administration program through audits, job analysis, salary surveys, and recommendations for job descriptions. You did not delineate only for their direct reports.
So you could.
This definitely is talking about the entire population of the district. So if you want job evaluation, it needs to be for their direct reports.
Yes,
the way I read it, I don't see it as a conflict. It says an administration program through audits. It definitely does say, and I believe we are required by the state to maintain the program. I don't read it the way,
right.
I don't see the conflict that's
so
being
now
suggested.
This assistant superintendent of human resources may evaluate any job they so choose in
the district. That's not what it says. It maintains the I read it. That's not what it says.
Condition.
Right. And I see both sides of the coin. I see how you could see how you read it one way and how you read it another. What I think we need to do is make sure that it's read. How is it read universally? If we need to add more to create clarity, then let's add more language to create clarity.
You have another section right down here that is supervisory responsibilities, and if job evaluation is for their direct reports, then that needs to go down into supervisory responsibilities and not in their overall district responsibilities. Job evaluation cannot be part of their job if they're instituting discipline.
The program is, though.
That's
what their supervisors are for.
Let's wait and see what
fresh,
Eric...
So let me think.
Yeah,
so,
Eric
you program.
Yeah.
You cannot have them doing both jobs. That is a huge conflict of interest.
Could he just think for a second?
Yeah, hold on.
Let's just we're done.
Let's just give us a second to read it.
I mean, that's what it boils down to. We've had a problem with this one just recently.
I'm sorry. Can we just stop and let the conversation sit for a minute so we can think? Eric.
More about job reviews.
That's what the point Don making,
salary.
So how are we creating clarity
right.
with
it's
that?
It's not evaluation of people, it's evaluation of, like, if they were to look at someone's, like, we have the professional relations committee,
okay.
where we talk about, with clerical, we talk about job descriptions and job reviews, that's what this is talking
about. How about
and if they're in the right classification and levels.
If
okay.
you want to delineate it, perfect.
Yeah,
right.
I don't think
but
it's
this can't sit like
it
this.
Should be a
I got a word choice there.
Okay.
Or you're reviewing
job
description
review
would be fine too.
Okay. So then, Eric, you're going to go ahead when this, and you're going to work on that.
Well, I'm just going to say something right now.
Sure.
Because I want to. And recommendations for job descriptions and job and expectations for job description. Job is redundant, I think. And recommendations
yes.
for job descriptions.
How about position descriptions?
Well,
for position descriptions and
expectations.
And expectations.
Right, I agree.
No, just leave the word job.
That's the same thing.
Expectations and evaluation? I see them as different.
No.
I think the whole sentence needs to be reworded.
I'm okay.
The whole thing?
I think it alludes to two different things. If Don interpreted it one way
yes.
and Mary interpreted
right,
it another,
right, right,
then there's something wrong with the sentence.
Well, you don't necessarily
not
have
necessarily.
To scrap the whole thing.
No,
but
you have to fix it.
Yeah.
So if you're in charge already, if you're maintaining job descriptions, then why do you need to maintain job evaluations?
I was thinking about that.
Just get rid of it.
Because the description of the job will talk about the successful performance within the job in the description.
So then just end with descriptions, put period, and not put and job evaluation.
Correct.
Don,
yeah.
Is there something missing if it's talked about just descriptions?
I'll use a catch-all at the end. I mean, I just want to make sure that we meet
thing.
The state requirements and we have staff and stuff to do it. But,
perfect.
Yeah.
Okay.
Blah, blah, blah.
Okay. Anything else in regards to this?
Give me a second. I gotta find the last one. The what do we have? Okay, the certificates, licenses, and registrations. Can we get rid of that because that means we have to pay for it?
Where are we at? Sorry, Mary.
Hold on. Certificates, license, and registrations. The Illinois Michigan Central Office.
Got it.
Unless we are going to put in there that at their own cost.
Can we get to where, I don't even know where
sure.
we're at right
it's
now.
Certificates, licenses, and registrations. You have to go down.
Page
2?
Second
yes.
page, top
sure.
of it. Thank
yeah.
you. Very good. Now I'm there.
Registrations.
Because we don't necessarily need them to be a Michigan Central Office Administrator Certificate holder. It doesn't help this position at all. There's nothing beneficial about it here, and all we're doing now is incurring a charge.
So,
unless they want to do it at their own cost.
By law, we have to have everyone, all administrators have to now have an administrator certificate, though. It's a grandfathered in for anyone new over the past couple of years.
So, it is
so we
required.
Could put it at own cost, though. We don't pay for it, though. That is true. We're not going to pay for it.
But I don't. Yeah.
Then it needs to be.
I wish.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
We all
so it is required by law, is my understanding.
So as, okay, let me look at it.
So you already do this, and you understand that as part of your job, and it's kind of defined
so,
the same way,
right? But
you
need
way,
it in
right?
there, then.
Well,
how much is it?
Say it's $150.
$150. I think we should pay for it.
Absolutely.
No.
Yeah.
It's
why
a
not?
Requirement,
if it's
required, if it's a required by law?
Because
do you know how many things
anybody,
are required for my job that
right.
I pay for?
Right.
I don't. I'm not worried
teacher
about your job.
We're not
think
private
think about this. If you pay for a certification, and 2 months later the person leaves and goes to another job
right.
with the same certification, you paid for that certification, they're taking to another job.
Then put the word in that they have to pay you for it if they leave within so much time. Whatever you
no, let them, buy, let them pay their own.
It's an annual expense.
Every
it's
profession
annual expense.
Pays,
no, it's
for
annual expense. Required by law.
Pays for their own licenses.
How
sorry.
Often?
Well, but I mean, if you, it's every 5 years, but it would be an annual expense based on...
It would be rolling. It would be
out.
Rolling.
Yeah, that's
okay.
what I meant.
I think if it's a requirement for jobs, I would expect we would pay for it.
Then now
fine.
We're going to pay for every teacher's certification
teacher
because it's a requirement for their job.
It is Pandora's box there. Then.
Yeah.
This is true. Yeah, this is true.
We're going to pay for every child care worker's background check every year. We're going to pay for everything.
And then we're taking
position.
The money away from education to pay
it's
for
not
this.
In the budget right now.
To meet
right,
state
it's
requirements.
Not currently in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
Well, see, that's the whole problem. We have a lot of requirements and mandates from the state that they give us no funding for, and we have to find out what to do with it. So, I mean, that's just
the
nature
of
education.
Of every day,
it just
yeah.
stinks,
well,
but it's what we've got. I truly don't. I mean, I see Don's position, but I can also see where if a lot of jobs require some kind of certification, the employee has to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
I get that too, and I think in the odd thing that you are in a school district, we don't have extra funds for any of that sort of thing, quite honestly. And if I'm sorry, but if it's something that our employees have been paying for a long time,
brilliant.
until the state decides that that's something that they're going to financially, you know, recompensate for,
mm-hmm. So it sounds like, did you have something done? It sounds like we would like, well, clearly we have to leave it in because it's legal, but we do need to add at their own expense. It does sound like that's kind of where we're at in this discussion.
Plus they should know that too though, right?
Right.
Yeah, okay.
Mary's point, you're making it so, you know, because again, if this becomes legal document, then.
Yeah.
No, I don't have a problem with putting it in there. I mean, in a perfect world, we could argue for, you know, we have enough money, we could pay for everybody's certifications, but we will never be in that in education.
Right.
So.
You good with that, Eric?
Mm-hmm. I can do it.
Okay.
Mary. Comma, at the employee's expense after applicable.
No, at the expense.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Like I said, it just has to not be at our expense.
So should that be put into every contract then that we've got with every employee that has to do that if it's not in there now?
Well, this is the job description.
No,
so but this is part of the reason why we made this a goal for Eric. As these job descriptions come before us, we got to be mindful of putting these things in.
Yep.
So as the situations present themselves, yes. You know what I mean? So, all right, does anyone have any other?
So is it, I mean, so just to preempt this for the future, is it, so it's, if this applies to anyone going forward, make a permanent change to that sentence for future things, so this is...
I think so.
And then if you want to revisit it, you could, but it'll be in there unless you pull it back.
I think that would be a wise choice. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
And anybody see anything else? Any other general discussion on the topic?
No, ma'am.
Anything else from our superintendent?
Thank you.
All right, business and operations office.
Thank you. We have the items for the consent agenda. The one item I want to bring your attention to is purchases. There is a request for purchases request for purchases for 15 cafeteria tables at Lobestall Elementary. The three quotes that Mr. Chatsky received are attached. He can give you a little bit more information, but I believe the reason the need for the replacement is a safety issue, because right now the tables that they have are built into the walls and some of them are starting to need repair.
Steve?
I don't know, Steve, if you want to add anything to that, please.
Take it away. So the prior principal of Lobestall did not purchase tables or replace the tables during the 2005-2015 bond. It just simply wasn't done. They may have been working, but they aren't now. So we probably have about 60% of those tables are workable. The other ones, I'm hesitant and nervous about allowing children to sit on because they're spring-loaded and they're very difficult to fix and they come in and out of walls. The solution, in my opinion, was to use the same ones that we do with the high schools. It's just lock and load and slide them over to the edge. They're less expensive. They're bench-style seatings. I did consult the principal to make sure that that's what she wanted, and you could fit more children on them. You know, so it makes sense that it totally... If we were to purchase tables in that area, we'd be looking at about $60,000 if we did them, you know, individually.
Same style, you mean, as they have now?
They came in from the wall and
right.
Things like that. They just simply don't make them that way anymore.
Any questions?
So
what's
the problem when they're up or when they're down?
What's up, sorry?
Is the problem when they're up or when they're down?
Well, when they're down, if they don't stay down, that's the issue.
Right.
The spring-loaded piece is—it's not something that we can continue to, you know, fix.
So, what are we going to do with the holes in the wall?
Well, there's one or two things you can do. Is you can, you know, we can remove the tables that are in there,
mm-hmm.
and then just lock them. You know, we could just simply, you know, bolt them across.
Sure.
And just remove the tables.
Ironically, I had just read a story about this in a different state, same kind of tables, and a child was very severely injured when the table came down when it shouldn't have.
And I think I want to say that after school they're at that, is that correct?
No.
And that scares me even more.
Yeah.
So that's why I brought it to Michelle and Eric.
I'm not sure you're understanding my question, though.
Sure.
So what are we going to do with the holes in the wall after you take the tables out? Because the tables used to recess into the wall, but now we've got holes in the wall. We've got the big, what is it? They're about 18 inches by by 3 feet across, right?
Yes.
And about 10 feet high?
Maybe,
and there should be, what
is
there, about
feet at least, probably.
Four or five of them on each side of the...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So what are we going to do with those?
Well, we can do one of two things. We could either... We could...
Like, we kind of need to, like, put bumpers or something on the edges of those walls because it's a gym.
No, they don't, and then that's what I wanted to make sure of. They do not use that lunchroom for a gym.
But they use it for a sack, and kids run and play in there, and now you've got all of these corners.
But we could just leave them.
Are we going to...
The closure, lock them, right?
We
do now?
We could, but I wouldn't... That'd be kind of premature. I'd like to look...
Yeah.
Let me take a look at it. Let me make a recommendation to everybody, and then I think that...
Bumpers, you know, would be cheap, wouldn't they?
It could if I need bumpers, but I think they sit
really
flush against the wall.
They do.
And they're rounded.
No.
No?
No.
You're not understanding what I'm saying still. When you take those tables out, and you will take the tables out, correct?
We could, or we could lock them in there, and you could just, they could be...
Why would you lock them in if there's ever been a question? You said you're concerned about the safety. If there's ever been a question, then you would need to take them out, right?
Sure.
It's the safest thing to do.
The space is like
the
one behind
you. When you take them out...
Exactly.
Right, just
exactly. Yes, when you take them out, now you've got corners. And we've got kids running and playing in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
So don't we need bumpers on those walls?
We could.
Right here. Because they are not nice and round like these.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think what the situation is safety right now, I think, is
right.
What I'm hearing is that there's a safety concern at this time for having students in the upcoming school year.
Well,
absolutely.
We are using bond money, right?
Yes, I'm getting there. If we purchase these tables, we can look at the expense for removing the others in a future budget at a future time. If we need to lock them in place until we can afford to remove them, then we can do that.
I think you're underestimating how simple it is to remove them.
Well, but what
if the concern is that they're not safe, then why do you leave them in there for a minute?
Well, my
because
thing is,
now
is,
you're liable.
What is more dangerous? A hole in the wall that you can't fill because you don't have the money to fill it? Or a table that's locked into place.
I'm not saying fill it. I'm saying bumpers. Bumpers are quick,
so
simple, cheap.
I agree with Steve that he can look at those expenses and let's see what those expenses are. My question is, yes, in regards to the funding of these tables.
So do it all at one time.
It says, well, do we have the money to do that?
We're using bond money. We have how many millions
and
dollars
general
of bond?
Fund.
How many millions of dollars in bond money that has
this
to be gone in 2 years?
This says building and site fund and general fund purchases in excess.
No, that's just
so
bringing it to us.
Yes. So where is this $18,000 coming from, Rochelle?
From the bonds.
100% from the bond.
Yeah,
correct. Because
yes.
It's a bondable expense.
It's
yes.
not coming from carryover. It's not coming
no.
from any line item in the budget.
No.
Okay. How much is left in the bond?
We have right now, as of July 31st, I want to say we have about $3.4 million.
And we have to use it by?
Well, that's not all of that. The amount that we have to use in the two-year period was the amount from the 23-mile sale.
And how much is that?
The total sale was 1.7. It's on a land contract, so it's still 1.7 in 2 years.
The total is 1.7.
Yes.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
So
that is in addition to the 3.4 that's currently included.
It's
part of. Okay.
Right. If your issue to start with is the reason you want to replace the tables is safety,
right.
Then do it right the first time.
I agree.
But don't fart around with that. Don't, let's just check out and see how much it'll cost to have them removed later. Are you kidding me?
Well,
you get a bunch of parents in there and take them out.
If we can use bond money, and if the money is accessible, then yes, that would be the way to go. But we don't know the answer to
okay,
that question.
Okay, I have a
well, either do it right or don't do it.
Are you comfortable suggesting a ceiling above the amount listed that would be approved for additional expenditure for removal and remediation of the situation?
So up to?
Giving some sort of a buffer range there so we can proceed and only come back to you if we run into some issue we don't expect. Steve, or just what do you think about that?
I could have someone out there take.
And of course, our preference would be to have see if we can just do it with our own guys, take them out and create some safety situations.
Our guys could take those out. That's not.
I know, but remediate the safety issue is
what
I'm trying to say.
What do you do with holes?
Just it would be nice to have an approval so that we can move forward in one motion. Is what I'm trying to say. I don't mean board motion.
So how about if we approve $2,000 more than what the cost of the tables are, then that'll be for bumpers. Our guys can take the tables out.
Don?
I would hope we would leave it as something that could be evaluated to address the safety. I think we do need to move because school starting, we want to be safe. So I don't want to specify whether it's bumpers or whatever they deem to be the most. We're sitting here. We have no idea what is the best method for making sure it's safe. But if additional money is being put forward, let's move forward on it so we get the tables.
So Mary has said $2,000. What if we, because this is coming from bond money that has to be spent in 2 years, we know it's around 1.7, what if we said not to exceed $25,000? That gives you quite a cushion, but you should be able to find solutions within that parameter.
Yes, ma'am.
How does the board feel about that?
That's fine.
Yay?
I'm comfortable with that.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Anything else on the consent agenda, Rochelle, that you felt?
The only other item I have is the accounts payable check register. We have, in case I don't, we were filling that out. We don't have anyone signed up for September 5th and 6th, so if we could get somebody to sign up.
We have Don.
People.
Right, we have Don, and then I do have it here to send
okay.
it out.
Are you going to distribute that? I'm not sure I put on that down.
Yes.
Okay, great.
I can do the 5th and
6th. Okay,
yes.
Great.
So
thank you.
Adam, you're the other one?
Okay.
Okay.
So for consent agenda, unless there's any other questions?
Great. Is there any questions from board members in regards to the consent agenda?
Employment recommendations are not on the consent agenda.
Oh, right. No, it's
separate. Separate, yeah.
Under
yeah.
HR. Okay.
5th and 6th. Friday after school starts.
Rochelle?
All right, and the next item I have is this is the recommendation. This is an annual recommendation for the to continue with the Macomb-Oakland Fuel Consortium for a one-year extension. It continues at the price that we had it for last fiscal year at 0.0155 per gallon for the deliveries over 10,000 gallons. So I'm asking for approval for us to continue with the Macomb-Oakland Fuel Consortium agreement for the 19-20 school year, including the estimated purchase, we're saying about 170,000 gallons of diesel fuel and approximately 17,000 gallons of unleaded.
Just a quick question.
Sure.
Underneath the pricing there, in addition, administration recommends,
mm-hmm.
what exactly are we saying here? Make associated fuel purchase.
It just allows them to continue to make the fuel purchase, because what you're really paying for is the delivery, because the fuel purchases are based on, it's already predetermined, what do they call that,
okay.
WAC
yeah.
pricing.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's just saying, yes, it's on top of the
okay.
WAC pricing.
Gotcha. Very good, thank you.
Any other questions in regards to the fuel consortium?
No, ma'am.
For TM? No. Okay. Anything else, Rochelle?
No, that is it. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. HR?
Hi.
Employment recommendations.
So I was going to,
my computer's still...
And I'm like,
yeah,
trying.
Coming
so,
out.
So,
is this working, Hillary?
Yes.
I can look at those.
Yeah.
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 It'll be
yours is still down.
A perfect segue in our conversation later about paperless footage.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Okay.
Employment recommendations, yes. Are there questions on employment recommendations?
Yeah.
Mary?
Yes, please.
Why are we, I understand that the, that's okay, it'll come up in a minute. We are obligated to bring it before the board to do these leaves of absence.
Yes.
But these are people that have taken positions in other districts.
Yes.
And I do not support giving out leaves of absence because you want to try out another job.
Right.
I won't support
that, that just, if they get... If they left us because they wanted to go to another job, fine, but we shouldn't keep them.
I think we need to clarify. I think we need to say if they leave us to go to another district, because there are some who go on like a leave of absence from one position to fill another position within our district.
Okay, well,
so are we saying
if they go to another district?
One person on here who's got both of those situations. They left to go to another position in this district,
and then from that other position in this district left to go to another district.
Uh-huh.
So now we've got two leave of absence for the same person for two different jobs.
Let me just explain this one.
And don't get me wrong, I think she's an awesome lady.
Yeah, yeah.
Love to keep her here.
Right.
But that it's a bad plan on our part.
So
right.
We did not. So the resignation is for her current position that she has right now. The leave of absence was granted for her when she was a teacher in the district. So the leave is per the teacher, the terms of the teacher contract, which I believe cannot be addressed at this time because of the terms of it. This has been discussed before, controversial, that there is a career exploration leave listed within the teacher's contract
that
extends out for 3 years.
That has to be brought to us for approval. We do not have to approve it. And this is an extension.
Well, but I believe we may have approved this.
Oh, I see.
Is this an extension of the original one?
This is, I think the terms say to go to the third year that it's approved.
Because
it's the same leave. It's the same leave that was approved originally when she left to become our administrator. That's
correct. Right. So this is not an extension of the leave that we did approve when she became an administrator.
And no matter what, if she terminates from the district, the leave is terminated.
Well, I agree with that. I don't necessarily
For clarity, this is an extension.
Okay.
But it's on the same leave, Hillary.
It's on the same leave, just like you said.
It's on the same leave, the teacher leave, not an administrative leave.
Yes.
Right. But we could choose not to approve this extension.
No. It's not just one. We have more.
But if we approved her...
We did approve it once, right?
Right, we approved it once.
But she should
not approve it again.
She stayed within the district. She just went up to another job.
Right,
know,
which is totally why
I'm just
we
telling
would,
you that the contract doesn't delineate the in or out of district piece at this time.
But to go to another job completely...
I understand that that's the concern, but I'm just trying to... The language
yeah, let's pull up the language of the contract and see.
At the end of the day, we do not have to approve it. That is why it comes to us.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing in the contract that says it's a given. We have to do it. Otherwise, it wouldn't come to us. That's a waste of everybody's time.
Even on the extension?
Yes.
Right.
There's nothing about it that's a formality.
You want to, rather than have us stand here, want me to look it up and ask him any other questions, or should we just kind of want to take a little break while I look into this? Or what
sure.
are you thinking?
I'm thinking.
Well, you can keep moving, and I can say pause. Let's go back to it. It's up to you. It's a turnout voting right now, anyway. At this moment.
What is the pleasure of the board? Do we want to take a break? Do we want to move on to the next item while we continue and come back to this? What is the pleasure of the board?
Let's take a break.
All right, we'll go ahead and take a break until we'll come back at 3:45.
Thank you.
So Mary,
yes.
This one here too, is this the other one you're looking at?
Seven.
Yes.
You're good.
Okay, so you're looking at two. You're looking at this one, and you're looking at this one.
Oh, there's one more of the black too.
Four.
Well, I see two leaves.
Yeah, I'm
so this
in.
Is, I could be wrong.
It,
this is
it
the
opens the one thing and it's a great talk posting, and now every the other
here's
thing
this
I
one.
Open, or if I try to open the packet, it just
and then here's this one.
Okay.
So which one are we talking about?
Hold on, I'm just
sure what problem here.
I think there's only two leaves. There's only two leaves listed on this recommendation.
Yeah.
There's only two
five.
Leaves.
But two people. You
correct. Correct.
Three leaves, two people.
Okay, let me look. I don't know the answer to that.
Let's look again.
Okay. So here's extended leave.
It's on page.
It is absence.
Right.
53.
Okay, is there not one more down? See, I'm used to it.
Yeah. I'm not seeing it.
There it is. We're kind of on a break.
Sorry, guys.
We're going to try to figure out.
Yep, that's
there's
probably
contractual
correct.
Okay.
question on.
So we're on break till 3:45.
From what time?
3:37 to 3:45.
I like how that works when I decide I have to take a break.
We all do.
We usually take a break.
Okay, so we're trying to look up what?
Language in regards to leave of absence in the teacher's contract. Don, did you want to look at this again? Did you mention?
I'm going to need a copy. Yeah, I'm going to need a copy.
You look like you've already filled it out all the way.
I did, but I didn't write copy. I don't have a copy.
You're done too. Okay. Do you want to wait until we fill it all out? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because it's not finished yet.
You can take a picture of what you have right here, and then when it gets done,
you can. Talk me into it.
Whatever you want to do.
It's become my favorite thing to
help me. Yeah, that's a good tool.
Right?
Yeah, I didn't put them on. I wanted to fill it out. Right.
Sure.
Thank you.
No, I would say in the case of what we just said, when we ask an employee to temporarily take a position, we absolutely hold their job.
So here's a different story.
Where are you at? I'm not going there. I'm just letting someone else look it up.
We're going to go work in
Bloomingdale.
See
if you like it.
Yeah.
Working at the DMC, but I'm going to take a job at Beaumont just in case. But you have to keep my job.
Surprisingly, yes. Mine's just about to load, and when I came back, mine's the only one actually working. No. That's so weird. That's good.
This little guy down here.
I'll fill it when it came in.
I will. This one? No, this one. Hey, this is really weird though, because I heard Clinton Township had some power out too, and he's
primary person.
Yeah.
Oh,
good. Hello.
Hi.
See why you can't go to lunch when we're having meetings? Because we are screwed up, my friend. Anybody want some water?
Just the day I've been having lately.
Water.
I literally could do all of this.
Everybody good?
Pick seven.
Start at the top.
Is not the whole thing?
You don't know. That's just one attachment. Do you want your packet open? I want to see. Go ahead. This is the one.
Do you normally use the packet?
No.
Oh.
Because the other one, this one.
But Rita, same for professional improvement.
Travel for professional improvement.
Or travel for
right. That's like, this is the one you're talking about. Exploring career options.
I'm just going to look at it.
So that's the one that just opened the packet for.
I know.
My guy's taking care of you.
Thank you. Better.
Yeah, but on this one, it says for one that we have to do it. After that, you don't have to do it. This is shall be granted 1 year.
I might have a question that could impact you. If you've done this for union members, for anybody like this, it would be a situation. If I was union, there's no doubt my pathway. And to tell you the truth, I mean, anybody would find against this.
Yes.
It'd be a done deal. It wouldn't even be a second thought.
Right.
Donnie,
Say what?
So I didn't get his legal contract.
Am I doing okay?
Yeah, with the Wi-Fi.
Oh, yeah, I got it. Yeah, I just had to forget the network and put it back up because of the password change.
So I'm good to go.
Thank you.
Right. Well, and.
But there's no financial reason.
That's a big issue.
For no reason, but we could just argue about that.
Yeah. Absolutely, as I think it should be.
But no.
Well, but.
I've got some now.
Well, but I know, but that's not pertinent to the situation in front of you right this second. I mean, it is, but you know what I mean.
All right, we are, is everybody ready to get back? It is 3:45.
Very fancy, Sharon.
Okay.
Charge over there, everything.
You should see my little speaker right now. I call you in the electric here, everything. You should know the hearing better. So there are two, we're back in session at 3:45. There are two sections in the contract in regards to leave of absence that we were reviewing. One states, the first, it's section C, number one, that states leaves of absence, if not more than 1 year without pay, shall be granted upon application. Purposes for such leave include, but are not limited to, study, travel for professional improvement, research, and personal business. Such leaves may be extended upon request for up to a total of 3 years. Seniority and increment?
Salary, like salary scale will not be increased.
Shall not accrue on such leaves. The other is section four of the same section C. Leaves of absence of not more than 2 years without pay may be granted to any teacher applying with the intent of exploring career options. Seniority will accrue on such leave. Increment will not accrue on such leave. The applicant shall provide reasonable documentation of his or her plan for new employment, which shall be reviewed by the Assistant Superintendent for Human Resources and the Association President. Those are the two sections that were found in the teacher's contract during break in regards to the discussion that we're having. My opinion is that we go ahead and pull these two items off the employment recommendation for this month. Take a look at exactly if we were to go ahead and move forward with not approving them. Kind of feel that out, especially with teacher negotiations coming up. We can take a look into what this will look like in the future and if it's something that we want to discuss during negotiation process. We can bring these two back on next month on the recommendation to see, to allow us more time to review exactly what we want to do with it.
I'll support that.
How does the board feel about that?
Is there any issue on timing for this?
Superintendent?
They're not here.
Not that can't be fixed.
Okay.
Okay.
There's no timing listed in the contract per se. So we would just, if you were to go ahead and approve or not approve, we would probably put the date back to when they left the district. Just understand that. That's all.
And
sure.
My point would be if we have approved any leaves in this, going through this process, it would be, if I was within the union, I would expect a grievance, and I would expect we would lose it without question because it would be discriminatory.
Well, we haven't had a grievance in over 2 years, so we're in good shape, right?
I will.
Oh, my. Okay.
Well, have you seen one?
I'll prepare one for committee of the whole. I'll prepare one for
committee
of the whole.
I would suggest we do it at committee of the whole.
Okay.
At least it gives us more lead time. Any other discussion on employment recommendations? All right. On over to other matters. Board operating procedures and revisions. As was requested at the last board meeting, the policy committee met and went over the board operating procedures and the board policies in regards to the new, new reimbursements for board members to make sure that we were not, that everything was in line. You can see here also as a part of our agenda, the policy committee meeting agenda and minutes are attached to this agenda as well, so you can see as far as the policies that we felt that they were in line and the policies did not need any changing, but that we did feel that the board operating procedures obviously needed new language, and you can see that language here in front of you in red line form.
So that means I got to get my stuff done before we approve this, right?
No.
No, this is actually...
Well, my old stuff.
Well, that's all. No, Mary, we're not waiting on your sheets any longer.
No, we have to, because if this isn't approved, then they're still good.
So are there any questions in regards to the changes that were are being suggested by the policy committee here?
The only I don't have questions about that, but I wanted to make sure, because we had in a prior thing my question about an accounting opinion on that. I don't see it in here anymore.
Okay. The question or the opinion?
Both. Actually, I saw one paper that had that comment in it, and I don't see it.
Should be on the minutes.
That's what I thought. Am I looking at the wrong thing?
Would you like me to summarize what I think?
Absolutely. Yeah, if you got it.
So the question was raised by Sharon about when it comes... Okay, first of all, it is everything's legally proper with this. When it comes to the district, the district's responsibility will be to issue a 1099. Oh, it's there. It's
in the minutes for us.
Yeah, it's in the policy minutes. I'm like, because I put it in the minutes.
I know. That's why, okay. I think I saw this.
Yeah, it's under the policy committee minutes.
Okay, that's fine. Okay.
So Yo-Yo is fine with it being a 1099, and the statement is that if it's a 1099, it will come out the full reimbursement. Use my language correctly. The full stipend amount will be listed on the 1099. It will not be delineated by what's reimbursement and what's compensation. So the only option of the district under this format is to list the entire amount as the 1099 amount. There is an option for part of it that if you attend something that we assist you with signing up for. Okay, I think this is the process. This is Rochelle and Nikki, just check me on this. But my understanding is if the district assists you in signing up for something that you want to use, that you're going to pay for, that your compensation, your stipend, could be reduced in that amount. Therefore, your 1099 would be smaller, because clearly we would have that evidence of that activity. Okay. However, there is no way of delineating the other types of activities which could be reimbursement or compensation under the old model. But that's up for... I can't be in a position to give you individual tax advice on this situation, but I can say that there could be a mechanism for which you to further delineate that with your own records, even though the full amount is shown as taxable on the 1099.
And that's just the legal thing? That's not from accounting?
Yeah, well, the auditor agrees with that as well.
See, and that was my whole point all along, was that it's going to change that. So everything is going to be on your 1099, therefore taxable, some of which wasn't before. And what do we do about that? And again, the biggest point was we made sure when we did this, the committee, that we had a prior that suggested that individual board members keep their own records for their own personal tax purposes and for audit for the district. So that's highly suggested we keep doing that.
Right, and that's what we added to the board operating procedures. It's a recommendation for board members to maintain their own personal records for tax purposes, and they may use the attachments as a reference.
So if we do this, then this is going to be effective
July 1st.
It was July 1st. It's our fiscal year.
Yeah, so
it's for this fiscal year, and the fiscal year starts on July 1st.
Okay. So I wasn't sure, because we hadn't done anything about it, if we were just going to say September 1st, because you've already turned in sheets for something else already.
Well, I would say just to fall in line that it'd be
just
July 1st.
Go ahead and call it.
And the idea is to
take
those sheets and keep them, so if you want to get those back from Mickey.
I have a copy of everything I ever sent in, so I don't need mine back.
Was discussion done?
It's interesting how you can make something financial retroactive.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's not.
Well, but
we're just making policy match.
I understand. There's no disagreement. Yeah. I'm not discussing whether you have the right to change policy, do whatever you want to do.
Right.
But to make financial matters retroactive, I don't know that you have the authority to do that.
I don't think we are. We're not making financial matters.
Oh, this is a change.
No, because the decision was made on... In regards to the
fiscal
year.
No, this is policy. This is still policy.
This is operating procedures. This
right.
is not policy.
Right. Well, no, there is no... what changed the policy, was there?
None.
Right. I agree.
So there's no retroactive on finance, because there was no policy changes made.
But you're changing procedures.
Operating procedures.
So you're saying you can step back in time and make it effective at an earlier date.
No, I am saying is we're not changing policy, we're changing operating procedures.
To an earlier date.
I'm making that suggestion. I think that we should, so that everything falls in line.
Whether we should or whether we can,
right.
Maybe
that's
two
my
different
opinion.
Questions.
That's my opinion. My opinion is that we should make this line up with our fiscal year.
I agree with Don, though, and I know that we want to do a fiscal year, but I would just say, what if we had decided to talk about this in September or December, let's say, okay? We've already started, say, the first quarter of the fiscal year. We could make a change at any point and then say, from this point going forward for the next quarter, this is what we're going to do. And quite honestly, I feel a little more comfortable doing that than going back to July. I'd like July, August, September, the old way, and then start the next quarter that way.
Don?
I've already submitted forms to the treasurer.
Right.
Okay. Take that.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter because the decision was
that
made
matter?
Before the decision.
What changed?
Never mind.
What changed?
You're not going to let me speak.
What
so.
Changed? What changed was the budget. That's what changed. The budget. When the vote was taken on the budget changed. So that's what changed.
Okay.
So as soon as the budget changed, we started discussing, the board as a whole,
right.
Started discussing to make sure our policies and operating procedures fall in line with the change that was made when the budget was approved.
It's not
so
that they don't understand,
hold on.
It's that they don't want it.
It took us a
I'm
couple times.
I'm pretty sure
times.
We can speak for ourselves.
It took us a couple of times. It takes you time to review the policies and the operating procedures, which we did, and I feel in somewhat of a timely fashion, to then... In my opinion, I'm only one of seven, but in my opinion, those changes should align with the change that initiated them. But that's just my opinion.
Yeah.
But that's
well,
what
I followed procedures. So, you know,
okay.
If you're,
yeah,
yeah I followed procedures. I'd expect us to follow procedures if you know, take whatever action you need.
And if it goes back to, we when the budget went into effect, which was July 1st,
correct,
then... How we do things will happen then.
It doesn't have to, though. It doesn't. I don't see that it has to, then.
Okay.
I mean, the budget, there's no question. The budget was approved, and so this is what the budget is. But the procedure for what we're doing with the budget certainly can happen. Like I said, we could be discussing this in December. We wouldn't go all the way back to July. We would move forward from where when we decided to make this distinction, which is sort of, you know, after we did this committee meeting and realign things, that sort of feels like that's where we move forward from.
Any other comments, questions? How do we feel about the language that's presented before us in regards to the...
Thank you.
In regards to the board ops? So we'll be ready for approval on Monday's meeting? No further questions?
Well, Terry, do you want to have anything to say about this?
What?
We just
yeah, I'm sorry. It's still August.
Yeah.
We will be voting at the end of this meeting. I totally forgot.
Yeah that's the point.
Okay, well, is there
Terry, we were just discussing the change from turning in your monthly thing.
Thank you.
To the quarterly stipend, right?
Okay, all right.
And so we did the, you know, you already got the minutes from the policy committee changing a couple of things.
Right.
So. I was of the opinion that we were going to do that starting with the next quarter. Others on the board feel that it should be retroactive to July 1st because we made the budget decision then. But as I said, if we had this discussion in December, I wouldn't be making this retroactive to July. I'd be making it start with the next quarter. So that's kind of bringing you up to speed to where we're right at right this minute.
Okay, so what is on the docket to be, what action is on?
Terry.
Hi.
Okay.
Hi.
Welcome
yeah, okay.
to the meeting.
Yeah.
All right.
yeah.
So currently we're on the agenda and we're under other matters at
okay.
board operating procedure revision.
All right.
We are looking at the revisions themselves and having discussion in regards to board member compensation.
Okay.
And the changes that were made to both board operating changes that may have been needed to both board operating procedures and policy.
Okay.
We talked about how attached you'll find the policy committee meeting agenda and minutes, and in those minutes we stated that we felt that there was no change needed to the policy.
Okay.
But we did feel there was change needed to board operating procedures, which is what is attached to the agenda here.
Okay.
So we've had some discussion in regards to the board operating procedures, in regards to should they be retroactive back to July 1st when the budget went effective, should they be effective after the first cycle, the first quarter, and have the board operating procedures take place at that time. So that's kind of where you came in regards to the discussion and the conversation.
Okay, I see. So, in summary, though,
yes,
had I not come in at this moment, what was the summary discussion of the board? Okay, Don.
Yeah, and what I don't think is appreciated, the board has every right to approve a budget.
Yeah.
But that doesn't change policy, operating, and structures or anything. It's just a budget. It's
right.
A dollar amount.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is a process for me. And again, it isn't just about this one item. When we take action on a budget, the superintendent, and in this case, I have some concern how the budget was prepared. I don't think there was a lot of discussion ahead of time, but that's somewhat separate. But I think the item that a budget does not determine action or isn't a process approved by the board to make changes within policy or operating operations. That's just two different things. So I understand that this is what we'd like to do, but I just would hope the board would understand that taking action on a budget, approving an amount of money, doesn't equate to a change in how you do things. That's a different item. And we could go into depth on what we did do and what we didn't do. That's kind of the point I'm here. And I'm somewhat frustrated that we think that does. But that's my point.
Okay.
Sure. And I just have a difference of opinion, which Don and I don't
okay.
often see eye to eye, so I'm not surprised that we have a difference of opinion.
Right.
But I think that sometimes the decisions that you make on a budget can have ripple effects in which policy needs to be reviewed, operating procedures need to be reviewed, and a change may need to be made.
Well, I agree,
so
but I can't see that one gives you a time frame. I agree,
yeah,
and that's where you're at now, but
correct.
I don't see how that
just
budget is being used as a time where we, to justify changes. But,
okay.
You know, it,
I can respect
yeah.
that. I see
yeah.
that, yep.
Okay.
Terry.
So my comments about this are that, and if we're going to be talking about this at another time, do let me know. But the board operating procedures and the revisions relative to the budget, which is what you just kind of filled me in on, I have two concerns about that. One that I've already expressed when we've had meetings before about, in fact, that same day that we approved that budget, I am not really... If the whole rationale for why we wanted to take action to change our budget at a time that it seemed inappropriate to make that change because we don't know what our revenues are, had to be done because we're concerned about the level of spending, I don't agree with taking action to increase how much money that the board is going to get relative to reimbursement of expenses and such. And then remember, my second concern was what will happen in terms of reimbursement for mileage and such manifests itself into what it may look like that the board is going to get in terms of compensation. That was one. And then the last is, I really was totally taken back by how that last meeting with the budget was unfolded, because the fact that there obviously were alternatives of the budget constructed and developed and studied and prepared for that I knew nothing about. Now, maybe I'm the only one.
No.
But I don't even know how that would even have occurred. So that's my concern about that. Yeah.
To address your first concern,
yeah.
The 2019 budget, or last year's budget, was $44,000 for the board. It's $38,000 now. So it's less.
Okay, so thank you for that. But I think at the time that we were looking at that, that may not have been the information that was conveyed, because I think, Hillary, you in fact said yeah, I don't agree with increasing how much it's going to cost. So whatever information we got at the time, now I don't know, Adam, if that is something that has since been looked at and maybe now is not accurate.
Right. No, so what...
It was conveyed at the time.
Correct. So I think we're miscommunicating.
Okay.
And I think the communication is the overall board budget has been reduced by...
$6,000.
The board compensation was changed to a stipend.
Right.
And that stipend line item did increase in amount.
Okay, that's what I'm...
So you're both right in regards to what you're saying, but it's just different. I don't think you're understanding that you're not looking at the same line item.
No,
do you know what I mean?
Okay, thank you for that.
So yeah, so the board budget was decreased, but the stipend amount did increase.
Okay, so then in reality then that probably relates to the decision about not becoming a member of MASB.
An NASB. That's a part of the discussion, yes.
So again, those elements of what we were going to entertain on that budget approval day,
yes.
Those alternative budgets that included those things, my concern is how that all evolved, since I was completely not knowledgeable about that. But I guess I separate between what goes into the board members' pockets and what is actually spent to develop and professionally develop the board. And so I may feel differently about how that money would be allocated. So, and I don't know if there was discussion or will be discussion about that, how that all evolved, because that was really quite shocking to me.
I mean, it's approved. Why are we going backwards?
I don't know. But I was just letting Terry share her opinion.
Yeah.
But yes.
I mean, I don't know if we have to have discussion around. I'm only asking the question. I'm just curious. And we have a lot on our plate coming up, right? Why are we going backwards?
Well, because there was no information for a few of us of how things were arrived at. So she's just making that comment.
You sent the packet, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I saw it the same time you saw it, and I was able to go through and delineate what each one meant, what was coming in, what was coming out. I don't. Where's the?
It was in the email.
Yeah, where's the?
It was in an email.
The confusion?
Yeah.
We can go there if you'd like. The closing down of an entire department, that whole amount, like that was never part of a discussion we had.
It was part of our discussion right here in our small meeting.
You guys,
two by
not
two.
Us. Not us. That's
not
the
whole,
point.
Right.
Some of us weren't part of those.
Okay.
Mine
right.
was the
so
first.
Here's,
so that's part of where it's coming from,
okay.
Adam, at least from me.
So
for
part
sure.
of it, I do think, and this is something that I don't think this is
worth discussing
right.
over and over, because the only thing it is a skunk and a peeing match. We really should.
We're sorry you don't agree, but we're not done,
Mary. What I take away from the situation is we have those two-by-two sessions with the business department.
Right.
And questions that are asked in one aren't shared in the other, and questions that are asked in the other aren't shared in the other.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
that's
how do we communicate
no,
better in the future
that.
So that the
it's
questions
illegal.
That are asked
right.
in one can be shared with the questions that were asked in the
other.
We can't
do that. It's called a round robin. It's illegal.
Right.
Actually,
but I believe the first time we did it, we submitted our questions to Rochelle, and Rochelle printed out all our we were with Bob, and I think Bob, did you write, somebody wrote down all the questions that were asked in the two by twos,
mm-hmm.
and then all of the questions and answered were shared via email to everyone. Is what I believe happened that first time around.
Well, we had the
so
same thing this
similar
time.
Similar to what we did
this time.
And
yes.
I think that process was great.
Right.
Yeah,
so we just need to work on that communication process of what's being discussed in those two by
twos. But see, addressing or asking a question or questions and sharing them, to me, is far different than developing alternative budgets where people come in and have been prepared to do X, Y, Z, oh, I like this, and, you know, different comments like, okay, well, now I'm going to be the bad guy. Like I had missed a meeting. I just, so that to me is a little bit off-putting, and as far as Adam's comment about going back, I just really feel that our action at that point in time, when we don't even or didn't know and still don't know what our revenues are going to be, because it was more of a statutory exercise in terms of approving the budget, I don't understand that. But nevertheless, we have what we have. But I just think the process is one that I think we should really look toward, because this has happened twice. This has happened twice, and I don't think we need to have a track record of what may seem to some as a violation of the open meeting act.
And I'm sorry, just to clarify, you mean by twice, the 2 years in a row, the budget confusion was there?
No. This is the first time that I've seen that. I'm just saying this is twice. The first time was our organizational meeting, and then the second time was this whole thing. So I just think that, and it's really as to your leadership about trying to do things that include everyone and have open discussion about them versus people feeling like they were blindsided and surprised. That's all. So as much as I think that this was a great process with Rochelle, getting questions, getting them all compiled, whatever. But then at that point at which maybe in some groups, what I'm now understanding from today's conversation, maybe there were some alternative budgets developed, and as much as Rochelle may have emailed them to us, but it really went a step further in my mind in terms of how that played out at that meeting, where that was just, I was surprised.
The intent, and Adam, the intent is that, you know, we're supposed to operate in the open for in discussions, and we're legally bound by that. And so when board members, would you mind? I haven't shared with information on a conversation I had with the vice president and yourself before. Would you prefer to keep that in closed session in private, or is that something I can talk in the open about?
It's your decision and your choice.
Well, since it's regarding the vice president, I think I'm required to give you that opportunity.
Are you saying that you're going to say inflammatory and negative
just
comments?
Just statement exactly what happened in our discussion.
That's your decision and your choice.
So you have no problem with me saying?
I think we should go in closed session for that.
I motion that we go into closed session for whatever it is that Don wants to discuss. That obviously sounds like inflammatory.
Well, I don't know that you can request it. I think that
it I'm not involved. Requesting it. I'm motioning it.
And I understand, but
and
I don't
I
think
can
that's
motion
proper.
It, Don.
You don't have any reason.
So Amy is the one who suggested that we go into closed session, and the reason is because
a disagreement with a board member.
What are our possible options to go into closed session?
Inflammatory statements, and she's requested it.
That is actually not in that. That is not in that at all.
Amy can request it because Amy was a part of the conversation, but what is the actual reason that we have to state?
I didn't bring my book.
It's
one
a request.
Day,
all
that
has to be is a request. If it's about Amy, all it has to be is a request.
That's the reason to go into closed session. No, we there's certain things we can do in closed session. The rest has to be in open.
Who's got a book?
Yeah, your book, Nikki.
You got it, Nikki?
I have mine with me every time. But
why don't we just call it a legal opinion? Because that's what Jackie used to do.
Because Jackie hasn't been here in a few years. We don't even bring that up anymore. And that's
thank
what we're doing.
God.
It has to be a written legal opinion.
Jesus, can we
it's
move past this? Anytime soon, please? Besides that, we don't have to do it in closed session if it's brought to the proper people. And there is nothing.
She has requested it. She's a part of the
I'm just making a general statement.
Okay.
I'm not saying we can't do that. I'm simply saying that if there is no resolution, then it is brought to the full board in open session to have a discussion with everybody about. So, but yeah, you can ask for a closed session.
Page 58.
Is it
Margarita
Day?
Say what?
Okay.
Looks
Looks like you kids are gonna sing.
Yeah.
We're actually on the same page.
But all I lose.
That was that I'm done. Okay. Let's see.
Didn't you? I mean, come on, it's just like church.
Where, Vicky?
It could be A.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay,
we'll go and close that.
Wait,
we have to say what?
Let me read it. Okay.
What it is.
Okay.
I'll read it for you.
Okay.
This is not me saying this. This
right.
is
This is for Amy.
To consider the dismissal, suspension, disciplining of, or to hear complaints to consider periodic evaluation of a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual agent if the named person requests a closed hearing. So in this sense, Hillary has to be okay.
Well, he said Amy and Hillary, and Amy has requested.
Okay, fine.
So we are good.
A person requesting closed hearing may rescind this request at any time, but then you have to go back into open session.
Can I say a second?
Yes.
Okay.
A. This may be a violation. Okay, go ahead.
Do you
want
to read it again? Everything's a violation. As long as it's not him. Fair complaints or charges brought against. Okay.
Says public officer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you want to close the doors, please?
Well, let's do the motion.
So Amy, or
I make the motion to go into closed session.
I did make the motion.
Right, Amy
you
made the
no,
motion.
No, you just have to request it. I can make the motion.
Mary seconds.
I don't care.
Yeah. Okay. Now, the only thing is, technically we're not supposed to be voting in this portion of the meeting. But if the board chooses to forego that, we can forego that to vote to go into closed session.
I make a motion that we vote at this point in the meeting.
Does the board choose to forego that?
You can second that.
I believe that we're violating because the named person is not making the motion. But that's, I make that statement.
You make the motion.
Right. Okay, so I make the motion.
Well, which motion are you making?
Show me that law.
You said Amy and Hillary.
Idiot.
We're in the meeting, but I'm not saying that that's not the
Hillary,
main person.
Hillary made the motion.
Yeah. To go into closed?
Yes.
And
so
I second it.
Hillary and Amy, okay. Right. And then the other motion to vote?
That was Mary.
And
I'll second it.
Okay.
Okay.
So all those in favor of voting at this time?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Roll call to go into closed session, please.
Mrs. Dubé?
Yes.
Mrs. Serviel?
Yes.
Mr. Lipsky?
Yes.
Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mr. Hubler?
No.
Mrs. Hilton?
Yes.
6-1.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye, everybody.
Yeah.
So are you going to just come out and get us? Or
yeah,
please look like
is there anything left for them?
You leave.
Right
there. I don't believe we have any other pertinent information
for
you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank
you. Okay, 5:00, we're back into session. Let's go to Board Treasurer's Report.
Does anybody have any questions related to this? The compensation is good. The memberships are good. The legal fees are obviously higher than what we budgeted. Supplies are good. Contract services actually looking really good, but I think the way this is going to be viewed is probably going to be a little bit different next time.
Yeah, it's going to be simplified, that's for sure.
Yep. So, but, we're solid everywhere except for the legal fees, obviously, but.
Questions or comments?
Oh, and everybody's was still under in terms of what was allocated, so I appreciate that. There was no awkwardness.
The legal fees are going to be, could be substantially higher with negotiations, when we get into negotiations. I know that Eric can't do it.
Right.
Who is going to negotiate?
Who will be doing it?
That's a conversation
right.
for another day.
Yeah.
Okay.
That conversation.
My mind's, I'm on it, but.
Do those legal fees fall under this category, or are those legal fees?
It would fall under you guys.
Yeah,
correct.
Okay. Not board, yeah.
They're set on another line item.
Okay.
Okay.
So you've had to reassign tasks from regarding community relations.
Yes.
There are a fair number of
correct.
Required tasks. Have we been have you had to go outside for any legal fees on that?
Oh, okay.
What?
No, I was just making sure we're staying on point.
Yeah,
no,
you
not
are.
Yet.
You
not
are.
Yet.
Yes.
No, not yet. And I would, no, and I'll, but I'll be presenting that plan to the board, how those things have been delineated in September.
You did send out, and I or even on the website, I see that most of that's been signed, but some of those are pretty technical, and I just would want to know if there are additional costs required.
That I'd like to put that on committee of the whole for September, but I believe I have that just about completed, but I think there's going to be some things that people will have opinions on about continuing versus not continuing and how they would be done. Legal things are covered.
Okay, good. Thanks.
Any other questions on the treasurer's report? Okay. So, paperless agenda software discussion. This is in regards to EduPortal and whether or not we like it and want to continue with it. And Nikki's actually going to head this one up.
Yeah, so I know we've heard a few board members say that they don't really care for EduPortal and wanted to move forward with something different. I just wanted to have a whole board discussion to make sure that we're all on the same page and that that's what we want to do is move to something different. What that something different looks like, I don't know yet. I would like to try to do something in-house where it doesn't cost us anything. My gut tells me that it's possible, but I need the time to sit down and figure that out. But if that's what we want to do, if we want to go to a different vendor or if we want to, you know, contract with somebody else or let me explore it a little bit when I have time and figure out how to do it with no cost, I would like to do that. But I think that we're all on the same page when we say we would like to move away from EduPortal. That's what I wanted to do.
An easy solution might just be, and I don't know the legality around it, but just using OneDrive and just putting everything on there and you can access, you just give access to everybody and we're good.
That's a Google Drive with cloud space.
Yes.
Right.
You can get 5 gigs for free.
All we need is a secured site, correct?
Right.
Password
so,
protected, yeah.
Yeah, and so we talked about Google Docs and other things like that. We just haven't explored it yet, so I just want to make sure that's what everybody wants to do. And then that's something that I would like, that's part of my goals, I think, with Eric anyways.
I think it's a great idea. I think security, we have a high level of obligation to meet security.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a great idea. EduPortal, this was a couple years ago, locked me out. And I had, there was a question there, do you agree to extend the contract for a year? And so before you could enter the site, and I called up EduPortal and say, take this off immediately. I don't have the authority to do that. And if you don't know that I don't have the authority, I don't want service from you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was an insult. And I could not open a packet and some information that I had to do in order to do it up. I was insulted by that, and it really indicated they really are not a firm that I think is knows what they're doing.
And there, you can't even address them until after 11 o'clock?
Yeah, there's a 3-hour time difference. It's very difficult.
Just to be frank, Nikki's making this request.
Oh, great. Oh,
oh, yeah.
Work hard.
Yes.
Oh,
okay.
But, and customer service has just gone downhill. I mean, we've had a number of frustrating conversations that should be 5-second solutions and take forever.
And the time that Don had that experience, I think they changed hands. I think somebody bought them out, and because all of their staff changed, and it's gone downhill from that point.
Oh, okay. How long ago was that?
Yeah. It was probably a couple of years, almost 3 years ago now.
But they were originally selected because they were significantly cheaper than most
we
any
were
other
first
service.
Client in Michigan, so it was dirt cheap. What we were, you know, what your experience because.
I think you have the support.
Yeah.
Right. So I think the direction would be to look at other options.
And we'll present those options.
Maybe.
And then if they cost money, you'll vote. If they don't cost money, then we can just have consensus of the board.
Right.
How about that?
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Wonderful. So board meeting minutes. As you can see here, all the board meeting minutes are here. The policy committee meeting has been added under here. I am going to ask that any ad hoc committees that meet, when we meet on the next board agenda, we'll place the minutes from that ad hoc committee. So it just be mindful as if the technology committee were to meet or if the committee that we have standing in regards to the meeting structures were to meet or anything like that, we would expect to see your minutes here on the next board agenda. But here as we look at these policy meeting minutes, there were items that were discussed in the policy committee that we wanted to bring forward to discuss here as a board as a whole. The committee would, if you look at the bottom line before the meeting concluded, the committee would like further discussion on seeking legal opinion, who can request legal opinion, and then the second item was to revisit and discuss the MASB and NASB memberships. So those are two things coming out of that committee that we would like, are being requested to discuss at the board table.
Which committee?
Policy committee.
Okay.
Just hearing how the tone of the meeting has gone, I think that both items are open for the board to discuss today. So why don't we approach the first one, which is on seeking legal opinion, who can request legal opinion?
Okay, I just had a comment on that.
Sure, Terry.
Okay, I saw the back and forth on that, and I just think that as much as I understand the points, I just don't know about anybody just requesting a legal opinion. And maybe it's just because, from my perspective as being a superintendent, is that, you know, it could be, well, I'm gonna ask for this legal opinion, I'm gonna ask for this legal, you know, where does it all end? It's just that some sort of process should be in place to have some sort of control over that and make sure that any legal opinions that you do get bring value to the board table in terms of making a decision. So just in general, I just think that we ought to have a process, and I don't think it should just be anybody that wants a legal opinion. But I also thought a lot about Sharon's comment about we can't have a situation where one member or a couple of members have the power to shut down the conversation or whatever related to a particular matter. So, but I figured there's a will, there's a way, and we can figure out something that would be amenable.
Amy?
As far as my understanding of our policies, we can take in verbal the conversations. We have a law legal firm that will give us conversations for free.
Sure, yes.
And we should be able to call, say, Eric, I want to such and such, and he calls and he verifies that it'll be free, and then he gets a thumbnail. Then they could bring it to the board and say, we have this, but I'd like to get more into it, and give your reasons, whatever they are. And then before the board, they vote. And it doesn't mean that it's going to be four against and three. It may be the whole board will go, yeah, we should get an opinion on this. Maybe two will say, I don't know about that. You know, and then it can be discussion about it. But I think that when we're going to be spending that kind of money, we need to have the whole board, or some, at least a majority of the board, in favor of it.
We can just have a mushroom.
Hold on, Don?
Well, within policy, our policy says the president, the last sentence under definition of duties and board officers, the president may consult with the superintendent and or legal counsel prior to bringing an issue before the board. That's flat. I mean, there's no interpretation. It's flat out. Now, the question is if there's and so I would suggest that by saying that the president has that authority, it almost excludes an individual board member. Otherwise, it would be stipulated that they could too. Mm-hmm. But I would think so. I think it's within, and I don't think we want to tie the president's hands that to wait until a board decision if they feel the matter warrants that.
Sure.
I mean, that's why they're elected as the president. But then I would expect that if the board were to ask for further consideration, that we'd follow the normal process. That's just what it says.
I'm just going to, because Don, that's a perfect segue into what I was going to say. Because yes, there is that single line that says the board president can request legal counsel. But if you also look in our policies, you look at Article 3, Section 2, duties and roles of individual board members, it says the board acts as a whole and only a properly convened and and only at properly convened and noticed board meetings. Individual board members do not possess the powers that reside in the board and may not act or purport to the act of the board unless the board has specifically delegated the authority of an individual member to act.
Mm-hmm.
Individual members of the board may not speak for the board. A board member who speaks to or otherwise communicates with the media, the public, or other officials on district matters shall make clear to the audience that the board member is expressing only that board member's views and that those views do not necessarily reflect the views of the board as a whole or any other board member. Mm-hmm. So for me, that supports what you were saying in the omission, Don, about if other board members could, it would not just delineate the president. So for me, this says that the a board member cannot singly ask. They have to act as a board as a whole.
But how do you act as a board for a whole if like I decide there's something that I'm really concerned about and I feel like I don't have enough knowledge about this? I'm going to have to say, I think we should get an opinion on that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have to ask the question.
Yeah, right? At the board table. At a properly convened and enormous board meeting.
Of course.
Yes.
That's a given.
Yeah.
But the biggest takeaway here is we all need to remember that not one of us has more authority than another.
That's
correct.
True. That's true. Okay. I have another comment, and that is some of the things that we've done as a board over time. When I was superintendent, we were able to have Neola, which is our policy holder, if we had a question, like you said, the quick question, you could always call. Mm-hmm. And Neola had a team of legal, and they would give you a quick that was aligned with your policy.
Mm-hmm.
Then the second one was MASB. So there was like a tier till you finally got to your legal firm where maybe you would have to pay. Mm-hmm. So now, if we went away from Neola, which is fine, and we are not members of MASB, so really we're relegated to only kind of a single go-to. I know we have those short little quickies that you said that you can get, probably
Clark,
from the attorney that we retain for that.
But we have a lot
Clark
of
Clark Hill, we can still ask questions in regards to our policies.
In regards to interpretation of the policies.
Correct.
Correct.
Which is the same as Neola.
Okay.
So that's still in place.
They're not going to tell you what to do, but they will say this is what I think the intent of this policy says.
Correct. Which was the same as Neola.
Right, right.
But then also, you are correct in the MASB not being there.
Okay, and did we ever get definition about the implications of not being a member of MASB?
That's item number two.
Okay,
after we finish this conversation,
we'll
move to that conversation.
So let's just assume. So we've got that stuff for policy, but let's just assume we've got a question that's not in policy, but it's just a legitimate question that needs a legal opinion. Who are you going to and getting it for free? Because Clark Hill helps with policy.
Wouldn't it depend on...
So you could say, hey, I got a question about this, and they'll say, okay, fine, I'll give you an opinion. I won't charge you. Just a little snapshot.
Truant.
And Truant is willing to do that any and every time you ask them a question for free?
If it's short and doesn't require them to do further research beyond what they know over the like what they know right then.
Okay.
No matter
what
they
could say, but they could say, I would have to research that further. All
right, and that's when you say, okay, fine, I'll get back to you.
But Eric,
that was what I would say.
But Eric,
right.
If you in your mind have, you know, in your mind, okay, Truant deals with this, I've always dealt with him on this, and this other one, I tip at Clark Hill, I do. And so when the issue comes up that she speaks to, you can easily go to the attorney that you know has dealt with this a lot and probably has that information readily available, or does it have to be true?
On board matters, we've agreed that it's true.
Oh.
And I think your question, though, also touches on who we choose as our legal team, our legal firms that we approve annually.
Yeah.
Right. They would have to be on that list because that's the board approved list of lawyers.
Right.
So he couldn't just call up Joe Schmo or he couldn't call up his uncle's brother's friend.
No.
You got to abide by
it. But
we have a palette. We have a palette of legal firms that he can call.
But
we thinned it out, but it also said if there was some situation where I needed to call someone else that I
it
could inform the board of
that. Right, correct.
And then
he's got to come back
I
to
could
us.
Do it, and then it would be discussed.
Okay, thank you.
Not very likely. But I mean, the bottom line is on board, I like the delineation between Clark Hill and Truant on this because there's some separation of one firm writes the policies, it'd be a good idea to have another firm be more legislative about them. Clark Hill's job is to decide whether to say, here's what we meant.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And then Truant's decide would be, here's what happened. And then I would say to Truant, here's what the policy says.
Okay.
And then Truant would, you know what I mean?
I see.
But I think we've decided that for board issues, it will be pretty much exclusively Truant.
Okay. Thank you.
And that's what we're talking about for these legal opinions. It's just board-based legal opinions as well. So it's pretty narrow.
All right.
Any other questions or comments? Mm-hmm. So I just want to make sure we're all on the same page.
So the answer to the question of who can request legal opinion is that it has to come to the board, and the board acts as a whole. That
for written legal opinion.
For, right. Eric can call if there are simple and quick one-off questions, but for anything that warrants monetary means,
written opinion,
all of that, it comes back to the board.
Well, I still read where the board president can request legal opinion, and I don't, on matters that need that for the board's consideration, I hope we don't put a barrier to that.
And does the board agree?
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
yes.
Yeah.
I would suggest that there should be a single barrier in that granted authority is not used to go after a single person, another board member.
Mm-hmm. Well, this does say within may consult with the superintendent.
Yeah.
It says may consult with the superintendent.
It's just that, you know, we've done that before, or not we. But it's inappropriate. It's just wrong. It's distasteful. It's
sometimes.
Just sneaky and crappy and rotten.
Okay, so we're all on the
same
page with that.
Are we moving on now?
On to the second item that we wanted to discuss in regards to MASB and NASB, and revisiting and discussing the memberships for these two organizations. Just as a little information for all of us, I did ask Nikki what were the fees for each individual organization. MASB is an $8,000 annual membership, and NASB is a $9,000 annual membership.
And I asked Rochelle before she left, the due dates are July 1st on that, so you know it's just.
So, when did we pick up the NASB membership?
We've always had that, haven't we?
Yeah. It says NASB,
Water.
National Association of School Boards. Right?
Water.
NASB.
I'm good, thank
Water.
You.
Is that what I said?
Water.
I don't know.
We know what you meant.
That one.
And do you know when we started membership in both?
It's been a really long time,
yeah.
As long as I've been here.
Yeah. Water.
How long have you been here?
Thank you.
That's put you on the spot.
20 years.
20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we can accurately say we've been members of both organizations for over 20
years.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Is that good? Maybe?
Now, isn't you can have one and attend the other? Isn't there some kind of deal?
So I'm looking at the email right now that I got from NSBA, and the question was, can we attend their events, you know, without being a member? And they said, no, they cannot attend any NSBA events with the exception of the Equity Symposium, as it was created to engage a broader audience. They cannot participate in webinars, programs, or other services that complement the work of our membership associations. So as long as we are not members of MASB, it's my understanding, and maybe Don can confirm this, that we cannot attend NSBA. Now, where I'm a little confused, and I have to make another phone call, is if we say, okay, we'll be part of MASB, do we not pay membership for NSBA? I'm a little confused on that, given the statement that I was emailed. So I would have to check on that.
Who has been to an NS? Is it NSBA?
NSBA.
I typed it wrong in the minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Who's been to one of their webinars?
Webinar?
Who's participated?
I've looked at some of their stuff, but
who's
been to
a meeting?
And I've been to their advocacy. He goes to all of the stuff, our meetings.
But he's through the ISD, so I hate to say it doesn't really count.
Mm-hmm.
So
a lot of us have gone to advocacy in D.C.
Right.
So once a year.
Right. I think advocacy in D.C. is the only thing I've ever attended.
Okay.
Yes.
How about you?
Yeah. I have not done the national one.
I would say,
just never.
Are
fit
you saying
in my
NASB?
Schedule.
Yeah.
Yes.
In D.C.
Yes.
I went to MASB.
No, you went to NASB.
I did. Denver was
NASB.
Yeah, I did.
So
we
went to Denver,
three meetings for $9,000 a year. That's a $3,000 meeting.
No,
that's
It's not three meetings. It's see, and having not gone
there.
Did you go to more than
one meeting?
Having
this year?
Not gone there, you don't understand the and I'm not being picky here or anything. I'm just speaking. There is so much at advocacy, and so much at the annual meeting. I haven't done the CUBE one either, but there's so much there that is so, I think, vital to board members, which is why they do a national thing like that and go to D.C.
But that's what I'm saying. When you break it down, it's $3,000 per person only if...
No, it's not per person. If you had three people at a meeting, then it's not $3,000 per person.
You're missing my math.
No,
I'm not. One, two, three people have been to NASB anything. in the last year, the year before that, I can't tell you. Mm-hmm. In the last year, 1, 2, 3 people have been to something NASB. It is $3,000 per person. If it's a $9,000 a year membership.
Plus, okay. Plus, hold on. Don't they charge,
plus,
Nikki,
the trip to D.C.?
Don't roll. They
no, we get a
charge number. For you to go to these meetings?
No, they do, but the particular one that she's speaking of, the ISD does reimburse us for.
Right. Yeah. So that doesn't cost right. us.
Terry and then Don?
No, I just, the one I care about most, if there is MASB, because that's the Professional Association of Board of Education members, and I have really found valuable their classes and the resources that they offer to us in this. But the NASB, I really, when I went, I got a perspective about what's going on in other states. And I just thought that was really, it was really well done. But again, it was an annual. But I don't know who was our other board member. But
if you had to choose,
That's next in the menu. Sure.
Okay.
Which would you choose?
Oh, I would definitely choose NASB.
Mm-hmm. Don.
I often don't bring back information knowing I would be poked, and I don't want to really, I know that if I talk about much, especially regarding this, it will likely get the ire of some people. I'll go back to MASB. Eric presented a fair amount of information about the proposed budget and the information that's coming out. MASB is a key player with working through the legislators, trying to inform and educate them on the requirements. And we're a strong advocate for developing the proposed budgets and developing the advocacy study, et cetera. It is in no way related just to participation of meetings. It's training and education. It's legislative action. The work that's done through the courts right now, we have where the legislature had proposed providing money to private schools to comply with government action. MASB has been a key player in arguing the cases and presenting that. And the worry about that is if public money is start to use for public entity or private entities, there may be no stop to it. That is the intent. I mean, I think anybody that knows what the scheme of it is that money that goes towards state aid, many people like to get public money into private hands on that. So many of these things are you know, part of a whole thing that is supported by the fees, not just the training or the conferences. I brought an NSBA folder. Many people here might not know, but in the reauthorization of ESSA, the NSBA actually has their language in the new legislation that returns control to local school districts. They're an entity that fights for everything from legal to legislative to educating the general public. It's a benefit to all public school children. We have over 50 million school children in this country. We have 10 million school children that live in poverty. Their efforts in equity that was talked about as a separate program is recognized to identify the needs. And again, the advocacy or the adequacy study that was done is promoted by informed people. Now, again, I don't bring that back to this board much, and I don't talk about it because I know I get yelled at, and I don't want to create an argument. And I would hope that board members do the research. The opportunities to provide and inform the community, our legislators, our staff, is something that I think we're all better if we invest in. Our future teachers need that support in the development of those programs. So obviously I devote a fair amount of time to these things because I value it. I know, again, I would be my question on my motives but I don't have a problem with that because it's not about any one of us. So I believe it's worth the investment, obviously. And I hate to see that Lance Creuse, who has been a known forward-thinking entity within the county and the state. I mean, they did. We have a reputation. Many of them for being, we do. We actually do. Lance Creuse is the history of Lance Creuse is very proactive. But I recognize, I can tell you there's a pressure around the state to say, if it's not good for me, then why should I pay for it, instead of looking at the greater good. I understand those are the times we're in. Whatever this board decides won't diminish my efforts or my intent.
I do have to say that.
I agree with what Don said. We had the discussion in the ad hoc committee, and I find that in both MASB and the NSBA, for different reasons. Part of what Don had said, MASB is
why we wanted to bring it forward.
MASB I find very valuable for the things that we have learned either in conferences or even just taking classes outside of conferences or taking them while you're there, whatever. And NSBA, I also do a lot of their online things. How many are part of the MASB or were part of the MASB thing where they send you an email for some urgent legislative alerts? Anybody do that? How many of us? A couple? Right. There's a huge value in that, and it's extremely timely for the multitude of things that MASB legislates for on behalf of districts, a lot of which a lot of people aren't even aware of. I sat on a number of committees on this thing over the years, and have found most of those people to be extremely dedicated to what they're doing there, whichever committee they're serving on, whatever things they go to. The cost of, say, even the NSBA $9,000 a year, like I agree with Don, you can't just cut it down to how many people went to one or two meetings. There's way more underneath that that matters, and if you're not part of it, you don't understand it, you don't see it, you don't know what it is, and if you don't sleuth it out, you will not know, because you don't get it. The one thing that really bothered me when this vote was had was we, in my opinion, made a very quick knee-jerk reaction decision even before we had all of the information we should have had, some of which we've all had before, but I've asked Eric to come up with a rough idea of a dollar amount that it's costing us to not be part of this. For instance, you used to be able to call up, and that's not just for board members, that's for superintendents, support staff in districts, it's for anyone. Could call and talk to an attorney and get a legal opinion on something. That's
are
a
you
small
still a
piece
member of
it.
Michigan Association of Superintendents?
I'm sorry, was I done yet?
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. We have discounts for insurances that are no longer part of what we would have because of the long list of things that monetarily impacted us. So, no question, there's dollar amounts attached to these things, but they're not, I don't find them to be superfluous at all. So whenever Eric gets those numbers out, and like I said, there's some that they're going to be incalculable. Like, how many times can you call an attorney and spend an hour on the phone with them and not pay them anything, or half an hour, or whatever? But I think that should have been part of the conversation before we did a knee-jerk, let's just get out of this stuff because it costs us $17,000 a year to do this. And again, when we go to advocacy, MISD pays for the scholarship part of that stuff, so it's not even part of our district. So
I have something, and then Terry.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
And then we'll see if anybody. So I have been very active in both MASB and NSAV. Right?
SBA.
There you go.
You'll get
it.
I looked at that and I thought, what
I'm
is wrong
NASA.
With my eyes?
It's so close to NASA.
Acronym soup.
MASB and NASA. I've been active in both. And the brief conversation that we had in regards to these two entities was, what is the value of them? Mm-hmm. And can you show me something that is an $8,000 value and a $9,000 value? What is the value of them? So it was MASB that emailed me in regards to, I had heard a discussion that you might be considering to leaving the association. Can you please, let's have a conversation. So via email, I responded and said, I'm looking for what is the value that would equate $8,000. And I never heard anything back. I never got any response.
They do have a click on their website for that.
But my thing is I have a hard time with the value because, yes, I enjoy going to these things. And did I learn? I would pick up, you and I talked about, you might have a lightning moment every here and there, but does that equate an $8,000 expense or a $9,000 expense? So for me, and I loved going to D.C., and I loved advocating for D.C., but in all reality, what I took away from D.C., I got out of the hotel lobby. I got out of the lunch table. I got out of sitting with people from other school districts around the country mm-hmm. and discussing what was happening in their districts. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily the content that was being presented by NASA, whatever it's called. You know, so I have a hard time rationalizing an $8,000 expense and a $9,000 expense. I mean, would I appreciate going to the annual meeting? Absolutely. Would I appreciate going to perhaps one or two of the classes, the 200-level classes? I mean, I took the, as soon as I became board president, I took the board president workshop in the part one, part two. You know, I mean, but to me, the value does not equate. I'm having a hard time coming up to $8,000 and $9,000. Okay. That's my opinion. Here.
Well, I did not realize that we were paying $9,000 to NSBA. And simply because, like a lot of associations that have national associations that are related, I thought the money that we spent on MASB, that a portion of our, what we pay, went to representing us at the NSBA. So in other words, we had people from MASB that would give input and would dialogue with and would whatever our national association. So, but now that I see that it's 8,000 and 9,000,
it's actually not.
It's not.
It's yeah. 9 and 5.
Right. It's 9,000 for MASB, about 5,300 for NSBA.
Oh, okay.
I texted you because
I thought it was
8,000. Oh, right. Okay. Okay. So what are the correct numbers?
It should be 9,000. I have it on the treasurer's report from when I paid it. So it's 9,000 we paid for MASB.
9,000 for MASB.
NSBA is 5,335. That's what it was for last year.
But wasn't that a partial payment because we were paying?
No. No, that's the total amount. It's just that we saw 24 one year because one was paid in the same year.
Right. But we, okay, refresh my memory because I know we just talked about this and I think the answer is no. We can't be members of NSBA without being members of MASB.
That is correct.
Correct, okay.
So that was a news piece for me. I really feel like the most pertinent information, networking, legislative, and everything, and even perspectives. I personally value MASB just because it's closer to, it's more relevant. But the other is that I just don't know about this whole concept that if I heard from some board members that, like, if we weren't members of MASB and somebody wanted to go to a conference, now the board member could still go, but it costs more money. Mm-hmm. So if that's the case, I think we should find out from the board, because I don't think we should cost our... When all is said and done, if we're going to be paying nearly the same amount and now all we get is to go to some professional development, I don't think that makes a lot of sense. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay. Don?
That confused me because I had talked to Don Wittrover. He asked me, and I'm surprised that maybe there's some miscommunication. I thought he had tried to reach out. So there's some expectation.
I got one, but I never got a response.
Okay. So they are available. I know we're looking at this year a substantial increase proposed by both the House, the Senate, and the governor. They're not resolved yet. That in no part is minimal effort on the part of MASB. They worked with the governor. I mean, that's what value is. We receive true value out of the proposed, that relationship and understanding and the advocacy. You would, without that work, legislators and the governor wouldn't have the inclination, Michigan's in tough enough trouble with the roads. The fact that we finally have brought the idea that education is a value to the state is in no small part to the efforts of MASB. They're at every table, and you know that. Mm-hmm. You know that.
All right.
NSBA currently, right now, as we've talked and I brought up before, has legislation proposed in both the U.S. House and Senate to increase the IDA funding to full funding within 10 years. And we're getting a significant number of legislators that are signing on to both of those. The opportunity to change our $1,700 a year per student for our special ed students to $4,000 a year per student is a real value. Mm-hmm. Not only to Lance Creuse, but across the country. If we want public education to succeed and we don't provide information and the pressure to do that, it won't. But it's up to Lance Creuse whether they decide to participate and support those type of efforts. Yes, we don't have to, obviously. But those are real.
Right. Okay. As a Board of Education, we are legislatively prohibited from lobbying. So.
It is not lobbying. They are not lobbying agencies. They provide legislature. They provide support. They communicate. That is not. I'm not going to try to explain it all.
Any other comments?
I just wanted to say I can tell you because I had to try to figure out how we were going to implement the curriculum and instruction parts of ESSA in Oakland County that. NSBA, as well as MASB, had a huge part in making sure that local control, which was a big thing, was factored into that, which everybody applauded because as soon as you take local control away, then now you have situations and decisions that are being made that really may not be in the best interest of us here in Lance Creuse. So I appreciated that, and I know that that was definitely
Amy, and then
I think the general consensus is we should maybe join MASB because we can benefit for that. It's the state.
How?
There's
when we're emailing them saying what's your benefit and they can't even answer that, they don't care enough to answer it, then why do we think that they're an advocate for us?
I think it might be a good idea. Let's see what our budget comes down.
Why would we take education dollars once we've already been a leader in saying, no, our money goes toward education, not toward memberships that are obscene amounts of money, and we can't see the value in them?
I'm sorry, Amy,
we can't put tangible value on it, and we've been a leader in saying,
Amy,
stop.
Finish?
Right,
I'm sorry,
yeah,
Amy.
I was
okay.
Finished.
You're done?
Sorry,
yeah.
Amy.
Okay, yes, sure. So two things. We don't know as a board what we don't know if we haven't had proper training, and that's part of what we get here. In spite of some members not liking MASB, there's still proper training that's vital to our work as board. Otherwise, we do stupid things and we shoot ourselves in the foot. I take exception with Mary commenting they obviously don't care because they didn't get back to her. What is wrong with making a second request and saying, hey, what happened? You're supposed to get back to me. There could have been any number of things that happened. Maybe they sent it and got one letter wrong and it went to the wrong email.
Could have gone to spam, maybe.
Precisely. I don't think we should just go, last once, you didn't get back to me, so, screw them, right? Second question is, what is the increase in MASB by not being a member? Is it 20 or 30%? Because I've heard both.
30%.
It's 30%. So we can still do their things, but it will cost us 30% more than it would be if we were a member. Okay. Good, thank you. Okay. All right, that is all we have on the agenda today, except for board action items. So we have already
Well, and then we're going to go into a closed session after our board action item.
But wait, quick question. Oh, so what are we doing with this MASB and SBA thing? Are we going to wait until we see what the budget is, or what?
I'd like to see your numbers, see what you come up with. That'll show the financial application.
Good or bad, and I just can't do that right now. So
yeah. Right. Yeah.
When we can, you know.
Okay. I mean, obviously, there's no big rush right this second, too. I mean, obviously, it would have been nice to do the thing in October, but, you know, you've got a budget thing coming up, and you're trying to do some other stuff. So
the conversation revolved around when the budget comes
up. So we're going to hold on to this until
the
budget shows
up. I think it'll continue. I think the conversation is to continue.
Okay, thank you.
So board action items, we're going to go ahead and vote on these. We already, like I said, we already voted to vote, so we're good to just go ahead and vote on these items. So in regards to the consent agenda, I need a motion and a second in regards to approval of the consent agenda.
I make the motion to approve the consent agenda.
As a motion by Dr. Spencer, do I have support?
Support.
Any discussion?
We have to have those two employees removed.
That's not here. Yeah.
Okay.
Does anyone have
any other discussion?
So, quick question, are we skipping our meeting? Because I don't have that on my calendar.
We don't have a second meeting in August.
Correct. We're not doing a second meeting in August.
Well, we have
right
made
now.
Changes, so.
Right.
Can I?
But after August, we're back to two.
My little calendar just can't keep up.
It's not for my discussion, but I think we modified one of the items within that under purchase to authorize up to $25,000.
Oh, with that understanding. That was my understanding.
Can someone modify the motion?
So, Terry, would you like to modify your motion to support the $25,000 on purchasing?
Yes.
Sharon, do you continue your support?
I do. Yep.
Okay.
So we increased that to 25.
Correct. And a roll call vote, please.
Dr. Spencer?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross? Yes. Mr. Lipsky?
Yes.
Mrs. Hilton?
Yes.
Mrs. Serbial?
Yes.
Mrs. Dubay?
Yes.
Mr. Hubler?
Yes.
And 7.
Thank you. So I need a motion and a second in regards to the Macomb Oakland Fuel Consortium.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Hold on. Why are you doing something else over there?
Hold on. I have a motion by Mrs. Spencer, and I have a second by Mr. Lipsky.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I did not make the motion.
I did.
Okay. I'm sorry, did I say that?
That's okay.
Right above it. I'm sorry.
Amy and Adam, okay.
I just know you guys are stickwears.
Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. Amy and Adam, yes.
Especially me, right, Terry?
That's right.
All right, so... You good, Sharon? All those in favor say aye.
Yes, okay.
Employment recommendations. I need a motion in regards to the employment recommendations presented, removing the two employees that were asking for leave approval.
And only two?
So moved.
Yeah.
And I saw more.
Second.
Okay, so what, Mary and?
Amy.
Amy.
Amy, thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Need a motion in regards to the board meeting minutes for approval for June 17th, June 20th, June 15th.
No, not 20th, 24th.
Hold on.
24th, you're correct.
Mm-hmm. 24th, I thought that sounded weird.
Yeah.
And 7:15?
I'll make a motion.
Support.
Motion by Mrs. Surreal. Support by Mrs. Ross. Mm.
That's it, if we do our last names, right?
There you go. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
So here you'll see there's a second hearing of school district patrons follow-up that's listed. So as in January, if you look at the top of the agenda, you'll see there's a note added to the hearing of school district patrons there. In January, I brought before the board the option I was considering as I was reviewing the board agendas of splitting the hearing of school district patrons into two parts, time limiting the first one and opening the second one. There was some contention on the board. Since January, I've monitored and tracked how much public comment we've had. We've had a total of two people come speak before the board in regards to that in that time frame. So I went ahead and based upon the data that I collaborated, changed this up so that there is 30 minutes of public comment at the beginning and the second public hearing at the end of the agenda.
For 30 minutes?
Mm-hmm. Unlimited. Mm-hmm. The second one is on, they can talk,
because there's no, they will each be awarded or allowed
the same
5 minutes.
Thing they have now.
Correct.
But if they want to get up and talk for 3 hours?
No.
Everybody gets 5 minutes.
Yeah, but if there's enough people to do it for 3 hours, we're going to let them do it for 3 hours? That's how it is right now. That's how it was before this.
But we almost never do that. It's just a major point of contention.
Exactly.
So tell me again why we're splitting this again.
So the purpose of this is to not have, if we do ever come across a point of crisis, if we do ever come across a point of...
I'm listening.
Yeah, I'm just going to use the perfect example of switching from 7 hours to 6 hours.
That's a good one.
And the public comment halted the action of the board.
Right. Yeah.
So what this allows us to do is it allows us the public comment, I feel, with plenty of time based upon the data that we received, to have public comment but not impede the business of the board.
Right.
But then we are also still allowing our public to continue their comments by having the second section that they can, that is unlimited in time based upon the members.
5 minutes.
They still have to group their comments if they are all going to go.
Yeah.
Correct. Sharon and then Don.
So that's a good example, the seven-hour thing. We did that over the course of a couple of meetings, too. I really think it'd be important if we say, you get your 30 minutes, you don't have to come at the end and start all over again. Because we had a lot of that, and that wasn't, it's not right. I mean, you have your time, that's fine. If you have anything else to say, send us an email. So
you mean the same person, Sharon?
Yes.
Yeah, well,
Nikki made some kind of, thing about that.
Yeah.
I don't want this to be open-ended.
Nikki made changes to what you read before public comment,
okay.
So it does reflect.
So it's in there?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Because that was hellacious.
There's a way within Robert's rules, and there's different things. When you're limiting 30 minutes to allow for positive and negative comments, The concern is if you only hear one side of the argument and then you make your decision, limited the communities. That there is just something maybe to look at. I believe within Robert's rules, there's, and I don't know, and even if you want to go this route or not, that if it's regarding a specific matter that you expect is coming there, are you for or against, and then allow for a comment for, a comment against. And that would allow the community to at least feel that the board has heard their perspectives, versus if you didn't. But that's probably a finer point. It's a thought.
We put it based on first come, first serve. So that we would not limit, or we would not pick and choose who gets to talk at what times.
Yeah.
It's just first come, first.
You can see it could become, if you have a really heated audience and strongly on both sides, and somebody said, get there early, and that's all you've heard. But I appreciate it.
We don't want to be picking and choosing who gets to talk and who doesn't.
There is a way, I believe, within Robert's rules to ask that question, are you a for or against? That may take.
Right.
Well, it doesn't preclude us making a change.
Correct.
No, we've never.
We will only have to use this in a time of crisis.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's better to make the decision.
Yep.
When we're not.
And one thing it gives us is that if people are really have an opinion about this, they're going to stay for the whole meeting and listen to what we said.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll stay,
mm-hmm.
which would be a nice thing for a change, instead of giving their opinion and leaving.
Wait, wait, can we write that in there? If you give an opinion, you have to
stay.
But
the
frustration would be if we took action and they hadn't had the opportunity. But it's a finer point.
So, and then you'll see the next item is board member comment. So I always think board member comment should follow any public comment.
Okay.
So then in your board member comment, if
you
choose
to
address anything, you have the option to do so.
Okay.
So being now at board member comment, anybody got anything? I think we commented it up today.
I do.
Oh,
yeah. I will say that if, John, if you feel that training in regards to Open Meetings Act will resolve the issue, I will support you on it.
Okay.
That's what I'd hope.
Oh, thank you.
Which I think
thank
that'll
you.
Be, I think Terry
I
asked for it to
yeah.
be on the next
yeah.
agenda, so
yeah.
we'll discuss it on the next
There's
agenda.
So one quick question on the end of that.
Yes.
When we have that one really big conversation, and we go again, just inevitably we will.
I think that we all just do what we did with the 7 hour thing, and we just, yeah, it's going to be a long night.
Right.
Just sit there and let them talk.
Right. You're going back to.
If we hit, you know, like 3 o'clock in the morning, then I think we call it off. But you know what I'm saying? It's just.
You
we
can
need
reschedule.
To, yeah, we can say at this time, we're going to do this, and we did. We came back.
We'll follow up the next morning.
All right, so before we adjourn, the superintendent has requested a closed session in regards to an employee matter.
Right. Quick break. I apologize.
Oh, yeah. Quick break. All right, you got 3 minutes. Does 3 minutes count? Is that good?
I'll go fast.
So we'll come back at 5:55.
I'm going to
Wait, because then we'll just adjourn pretty much.